Okay, welcome back. For those of you that are already back from the break and the rest are on the way, we have someone hitting the chimes and shutting the light, turns the lights on and off across the hall to get everyone back. But the next topic I find very fascinating, and that is the U.S. federal and state taxation with respect to a U.S. branch of a foreign corporation. From a federal perspective, of course, foreign corporations that are engaged in a trade or business with effectively connected income have to worry about not only federal income taxes, but also the branch level taxes. But many foreign corporations that operate in the United States and don't have a permanent establishment and who are eligible for treaty benefits and therefore don't pay any federal income or branch profits taxes are shocked to learn that our treaties don't cover state and local income taxes. So with that, our co-speakers for this segment are Peter Connors, who is a partner with Orrick, Herrington, and Sutcliffe. He's going to cover the federal tax aspects, and Jeffrey Friedman, who is a partner with Sutherland, Asbill, and Brennan, will be covering the state and local tax aspects this afternoon. Peter Connors is a frequent lecturer for a variety of major organizations, including the International Fiscal Association, where Peter has served as vice president of the New York City chapter since 2008. Peter has published over 100 articles and reports on various tax planning subjects. Peter is uniquely qualified to address his topic today as being the author of BNA Portfolio 6480, the branch-related taxes of Section 884. And Peter earned his LLM here at NYU. Jeff Friedman is a state and local tax partner with Sutherland. Prior to joining Sutherland, Jeff actually was a tax partner with KPMG in the Washington National Tax Practice, focusing, of course, on state and local tax matters. And before joining KPMG, Jeff served as an attorney advisor in the U.S. Department of the Treasury's Office of Tax Policy, where he assisted with the development of the U.S. government's position on domestic and international electronic commerce tax issues. Gentlemen.
Thank you, Larry. So welcome back, everybody. I know the break was helpful in getting everybody refreshed and digging into this meaty topic. So let's start going. So I'm Peter Connors, and I'm going to talk about the U.S. federal income tax issues associated with the branch. Jeff is going to talk about the state tax issues. And we're going to have a little dialogue during the course of our otherwise separate presentations. Jeff is very knowledgeable in the international tax aspect as well. So just starting out on the federal side, the foreign corporations are taxed depending on whether or not they have effectively connected income or non-effectively connected income. Non-effectively connected income is subject to the 30% withholding tax, but effectively connected income is subject to regular corporate tax rates as very much the same way that a U.S. corporate taxpayer would be taxed. The issue that comes up in determining whether or not a taxpayer is subject to that regime is whether or not they have a trade or business, and then whether or not they have effectively connected income. Merely being an investor in the U.S. is not a trade or business, and that does not give rise to effectively connected income. The rules apply differently with respect to business income and non-business income slash portfolio income. Generally, U.S. source business income is going to be ECI, and non-business income is going to be ECI depending on whether or not an asset use test or business activities test is met. And foreign income is not usually going to be ECI, but if it's attributable to a U.S. office, it may well be. Now, moving away from the code, in the treaty context, which applies for federal but not state tax purposes, as Larry said, The issue or the analysis is slightly different. The issue is whether or not there is a permanent establishment in the U.S. And if there is a permanent establishment, then it's only the only income that's going to be taxable is that income which is attributable to the permanent establishment. So the ECRI rules are really not the the benchmark. Rather, it's a profit attribution test. And we went over this a little bit in one of the treaty panels earlier. ECRI may also arise through the ownership of a partnership interest. General pass-through principles apply in attributing that income to a foreign partner. And I would say that as a general rule, most foreign taxpayers, foreign corporations, do not intentionally go into branch form. There are some that do so because of their nature of their business. They need the capital associated with head office, like a bank or an insurance company. But more often than not, you're trying to avoid this, not only for the because of the U.S. federal tax rules, but rather because of the state tax rules, which I think in some respects can be worse than the federal rules. So very often you see the branch rules and ECRI rules coming up by inadvertence rather than real planning. And then finally, my last bullet point here mentions that ECR raises the potential for the branch profits tax. We're going to be talking about that later on in the discussion. Once there's been a determination that there is ECI, the taxpayer is allowed to take deductions in the computation of his taxable income. The methodology is based on allocation and apportionment principles. And this often means that an expense may be incurred not by the branch itself, but rather by the head office, and that expense gets allocated to the branch, even though it's occurred outside the U.S. And that's an important part of tax planning in this area. The one trap in this area, though, is that in order to be allowed to take a deduction, that a return must be filed on a timely basis. A return, or at the very least, a protective tax return must be filed on a timely basis. And with respect to interest, which is an enormous problem with respect to financial institutions, the regulations under 882-5, and you heard about this in Sean and Tom's panel earlier, adopt a fungibility approach and allocate interest among the taxpayers' assets to the U.S. branch. Effectively to the assets which are ECI. It's a pretty complicated methodology involved in allocating deductions. There are ratios that are used to determine how the liabilities are allocated. You can either use fixed ratios or you can use actual ratios. Fixed ratio of 50% in the non-banking context, a 95% debt equity ratio in the banking context. You can select fair market value, or you can select book value to determine how that you do your allocations. And the process itself is a three-step formula. You determine the assets, then you determine the effectively connected liabilities, and then you calculate the amount of interest expense paid or incurred on the U.S. booked liabilities, and then you make adjustments to the extent that there are differences between the book liabilities and the U.S. connected liabilities. Complicated, but yet very important part of the planning in this area. And we talked today, Sean and Tom talked about the AOA and the OECD transfer pricing methods, and one of the issues was discussed was the treatment of interbranch transactions and how capital was to be determined. And that, before the OECD transfer pricing principles had become the law of the land in certain treaties, there was a huge debate as to whether or not interbranch transactions could be recognized or should be recognized. And or whether you were forced, at least for interest expense determination purposes, to use that formula that I described earlier, which is, you know, which adopts a fungibility approach. And so, again, the issue was, well, could you deduct the interest expense paid to head office? And if you could, well, were there any limitations on the amount of interest? Did you need capital, something that you wouldn't ordinarily have at the branch? And this was the subject of litigation during the 90s and the early 2000s in the NatWest case. And the NatWest case actually, the claims court actually concluded that that the separate entity approach that's in Article 7.2 of the 75 treaty and is now in the current treaty allowed this this separate entity or treaty method approach. And as Tom and Sean said, this has been adopted in several of the treaties that have been recently either entered into or updated through protocols. Seven of the treaties are listed at the bottom of the slide. I will say what's interesting is that even though the most recent treaties all adopt, or many of the most recent treaties adopt the OECD transfer pricing methods, and you know, there's an express statement in the explanation that some of them don't. And most notably, the French US treaty, even though it was recently updated, doesn't have this type of provision in it. So you can't just generalize just because it's a recent treaty, it'll have it. You have to kind of look at the treaty itself. Now let's go to the branch profits tax. And once there is a trader business, once there is ECI, then there is a branch or a deemed branch. And a US branch is treated effectively as a US subsidiary for purposes of calculating a dividend equivalent tax. That is to say, before 1986, let me start back. Before 1986, there was no branch profits tax. There were second-tier interest and dividend withholding taxes that were probably not allowable under the treaties and probably not collectible anyway. And in recognition of this, in the 1986 Act, the code was changed, and 884 was introduced, and that imposed the branch profits tax. And the idea was to treat a branch as if it were a U.S. corporation, at least with respect to remittances and also with respect to certain interest-related taxes. And so they came up with this notion of the branch profits tax that would tax deemed remittances of E&P that was ECI to the outside of the U.S. And the determination is based on asset levels. If there's a reduction in assets, then it's a deemed remittance. But to have a deemed remittance, you have to have E&P. And so there's the analysis of basically looking at the combination of the E&P, the increases in E&P, and the asset levels from year to year. And part of the analysis is just to determine whether or not there's been a reduction in the branch assets. The branch assets are the assets which generate ECI, and the liabilities are determined using the 882-5 effectively connect, or the allocation principles. So we allocate liabilities to the U.S. based on the asset levels in the U.S., and those liabilities go into the determination of the net equity. Net equity moves or does not move, that may or may not be a deemed remittance. And the issue in this area is that since the calculation of liabilities is based on a formula, depending on whether you're using the actual ratio or the fixed ratio, things can happen. And even though you don't think you have a remittance, you may in fact have a remittance. So just a couple of other points, and we'll go through some examples. But we're talking about something which is designed to equate a branch to a U.S. subsidiary. and to create a dividend equivalent. So therefore, what happens is you don't just look at ECI, you look at effectively connected E&P. So the term in the regulations is ECI, E&P. It's a complicated term, but you know, the bottom line is that you start with your E&P, you start with the ECI, and then you make the adjustments for E&P, just as if you were dealing with a regular U.S. subsidiary. Corporate partners may be subject to the branch profits tax. Individual partners are not subject to the branch profits tax. It's only a corporate level tax. And the branch profits tax applies to gains on the sales of U.S. RPIs. Whether or not the underlying asset is ECI, it could be simply an investment in U.S. real property, but it does not apply to the sale of a U.S. real property holding company. There was a concern that there might be an extra layer of taxation, maybe a triple taxation, if that were the case. So let's just take a look at a simple example. In this example, we have ECI of $100. It's taxed at a 35% rate. At the beginning of the year, we have 500 of assets. At the end of the year, we have 500 of assets. So the net equity has not moved. And there's been an increase of effectively connected E&P of $65. And this slide illustrates that there is going to be a deemed equivalent amount, because $65, the increase in effectively connected E&P, is not accompanied by an increase in the asset level of the foreign corporation. So you see then the branch profits tax, assuming no treaty applies, would kick in, be subject to 30% tax, and the total tax burden of the branch would go up to $54.5. The next slide goes through what happens when there are liabilities, and the calculation shows a scenario where the taxpayer used the fixed ratio of 50% to determine its liabilities. The liabilities are based on the asset level, so we start out with 1,000 of assets. We have 500 of liabilities. We have more E&P, so then we have more liabilities, but we are using a ratio here that's a fixed ratio, and the liabilities are 533, so there we have U.S. net equity of 532 compared to 500. So there's been an increase in U.S. net equity of 32, but we've had E&P of 65, and so we haven't had enough of an increase to avoid the branch profits tax. The other branch-related tax relate to interest. There are two. There's a branch profits tax, and then there's a branch interest level taxes. And the first category relate to interest, which is on the U.S. books. That is really interest paid by the branch. If you have book liabilities and liabilities paid interest is paid on those liabilities, that will be treated as if it were paid from a U.S. corporation and subject to withholding tax and all the other rules that go along with interest. And therefore, this also means that to the extent that there are exemptions from withholding, whether it's portfolio interest, bank deposit interest, or any treaty reductions, all those rules will apply. The other tax that comes up in this area is called the excess interest tax, and it applies to the interest expense that is on liabilities which are in excess of the liabilities which are on the books. So it's an excess interest tax. You compare the connected liabilities that come up on the formula to the book liabilities, and to the extent that the excess liability, their connected liabilities exceed the book liabilities, then there is another 30% tax that would be imposed. The theory being, well, this is like a U.S. subsidiary of the foreign corporation, and if it were paying interest to the foreign corporation, then there would be a 30% withholding tax. So let's just take a quick look at how this works. The first example sets forth the case where the booked liabilities, the liabilities from the book of the U.S. branch, are the same as the U.S. connected liabilities using the ratio that we talked about earlier. Well, here the ratio is 80%. So we start out with U.S. assets of 1,000 and U.S. book liabilities of 800 because of the 80% ratio. The branch interest is $40. The asset cost of borrowing is 5%. And U.S. connected liabilities, that 80% times 1,000 equal 800. And we see that there's a zero on the next line, and that zero relates to whether or not there is a difference between the book liabilities and the connected liabilities, and there is none. That's our example. This is our base case. And so we see here that the interest deduction is going to be really the interest is on the books. The $40 is a very, very basic case, and there's not going to be any excess interest tax. We then move on to a little more complicated example where the book liabilities are less than the U.S. connected liabilities. And again, our base case is on the left. But in this variation of the example, there are no book liabilities. And so therefore, all the liabilities are excess liabilities. We're really comparing 800 connected liabilities to zero, which are on the book. And therefore, we have 800 of excess liabilities. And all the interest expense that relates to the excess connected liabilities is subject to this 30% tax. There is another set of rules that applies when the book liabilities are greater than the U.S. connected liabilities. That's called the scaling ratio. That's a topic for another day. So another point to just keep in mind here is that this is just the starting point for the determination of the interest expense deduction and the excess interest tax, which are, again, I'm calling these branch-related taxes. Once you've gone through the calculations, you need to apply the other sets of rules that would apply to interest expense. So for instance, you might apply 263 to determine whether or not interest has got to be capitalized, or you might apply the earnings stripping rules to determine whether or not interest expense has got to be deferred. So if we have a branch, we often think about branch termination issues. And one rule that we know from dealing with regular corporations is that if you liquidate a U.S. corporation, there is no dividend. The liquidation does not trigger a dividend withholding tax. And likewise, the same rule applies if you terminate a branch. It's, you know, following the analogy, it's not going to result in a branch termination tax. The rules are a little more difficult to work with here because you can't have, it's kind of like a branch reincorporation rule. You can't have, during the following 3-year period, you can't have any ECI or assets that would be otherwise producing effectively connected income. So there's planning here, but it takes, and there's also a requirement to extend the statute of limitations, there are rules there that you can work with. We often see branches that might want to be incorporated, and there is an exemption from the branch profits tax for a 351 transaction, and the corporation that takes over the assets simply has to make an E&P adjustment so that none of the E&P is lost, and any disposition of the stock of that U.S. corporation will actually trigger the branch profits tax. One thing that might be not obvious is the fact that this exemption for 351 transactions only applies to transfers to U.S. corporations. It doesn't apply to transfers to foreign corporations. Now, we talked a lot about earlier today about treaty issues, and 884 was really the first treaty override, wasn't it? It was there. It was, there was the non-discrimination articles all prevented, or, you know, many of them prevented the branch, the second tier withholding taxes. So Congress looked at this and said, no, we've got to find some mechanism for dealing with this. And there was, you know, very strong legislative history to propose regulations, to come up with a regulatory scheme that permitted the IRS to, or required taxpayers that wanted to take advantage of treaties to meet certain thresholds. And the regulations that were adopted in 1988 or so came up with a scheme which really was the blueprint for the modern LOB provisions that you'd see in treaties. And they came up with three tests, an ownership-based erosion test, a public ownership test, and an active business test, and a fourth test, which was, well, we can always look at this foreign entity, and it, you know, if it doesn't meet the, either of these tests, we can get a ruling, which is comparable to the competent authority procedure that you'd see in most LOB provisions. And so the way this scheme was developed was that when the statute was adopted, there still was these cadre of treaties that had the non-discrimination article, and therefore the branch profits tax wouldn't apply. But gradually, but to gain the benefit of the treaty, you had to be able to fit within one of these qualified residence provisions. But over the course of time, virtually all the treaties have been renegotiated. And now on a going forward basis, you have to fit in the LOB provision to avoid the branch profits tax, which generally speaking brings down the branch profits tax to the lower rate, lower dividend withholding rate, you know, the one that applies where you have a 10% ownership level in the corporation. The last point I'd like to just talk about with respect to treaties, hybrid entities, that, you know, again, they raise lots of complex issues. And certainly, very often we're asked, and we saw earlier today, Keith was talking about using an LLC to do some tax planning in the U.S. And the issue is whether or not the LLC would get treaty benefits. And we know that there was some mention earlier today that the 894 regulations have a anti-hybrid entity rule with respect to withholding tax. In the regulations, that is to say, if you're dealing with a hybrid entity, you will not, and where the owner of the income is different than for U.S. purposes and for foreign purposes, then treaty benefits will not be available. When they issued the regulations under 894, they reserved on the treatment of income that was effectively connected, and the more modern treaties have a clause in there that mirrors the 894 language, and there's an open question today as to whether or not the treaties actually are available with respect to the branch profits tax. There's just a huge debate in the academic community about that, and it gets even more interesting when you deal with reverse hybrid entities, which may be corporations. You're checking a box, and you've got a corporation for U.S. purposes, but not for foreign purposes. No answers there, but something to really think about as you do your tax planning. So that's the overview of the U.S. federal tax aspects. We're now going to move on to the state tax issues.
All right. Thank you, Peter. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jeff Friedman, and I'm here to talk with you about state and local tax. Thank you for staying here with me. I'm sure it's a little bit different than a lot of the other material that you've heard here so far. In fact, if you like Peter's presentation, you're probably going to hate mine. I should probably warn you at the front end. I have no code sections, no interesting examples. And in fact, I'm not even going to follow the slides. I don't follow slides. I don't read bullets. I don't do that. I teach state and local tax at some lesser-known, lesser-acclaimed law school, and you know, I pretty much start on the first day, and I stop talking on the last day of class, and we see where we end up, and that's what we test on, I guess. So I'm very proud of myself. I created this slide. Oh, and I should also note that please stop me and make comments, tell me I'm wrong, ask questions, whatever, for a couple reasons. One is I much would rather have the back and forth, give and take, and I promise to repeat back whatever questions or comments folks make so everybody can hear them. Also, I committed to doing this a while ago. I travel a lot, and I look at my calendar, and then I hem and haw about whether I can make it, and I was in South Carolina this morning, and could I get here in time, and ultimately, KPMG and NYU were kind enough to accommodate my goofy schedule, but one thing I forgot, and that's today is my wife's birthday. Yeah, not good. So I have a car waiting for me outside, and I'm going to run right out of here after we're done speaking, so... this is your chance. Let me have it, because I am going to like be right out of here and sit on the tarmac at LaGuardia right after this. But I'm proud of myself for creating this slide. This is the only one I am going to talk about. I'm not even going to hit the advance button, I promise. Look at that right there. This slide really summarizes everything I want to talk about as it relates to inbound transactions for state and local tax purposes. And I could probably talk a few days about it. And in fact, don't tell my students that I created this slide, because they could probably avoid six classes with this one slide. So I probably should ask you all to keep it to yourselves, OK? So can we have that deal? All right, so here goes. And again, please join me in this conversation. State and local tax is very, very different. Let me start off by stating the obvious. Very, very different. Different set of rules. And there's good reasons why we have different sets of rules for state and local tax purposes. Some of that is a decision that the states have made, and some of it is a decision that's forced upon them as a result of the Commerce Clause being applied to states and localities that doesn't apply to the Internal Revenue Service or to Congress, who writes the Internal Revenue Code. So we have a different, very different playing field here, but we have a lot of similar tensions with different responses. I wanted to know, these are more pictures taken than I think my mother ever took of me. Look at this. And I don't have a good side, so I'm really screwed here. Keep going. It's all good. In fact, Peter, if you want to come over, I'll give you a hug. So in jurisdiction of tax, I want to talk about income tax. But before talking about income tax, I do have to mention that there's a debate going on in our state tax world regarding what set of jurisdictional rules apply for tax types. I know this sounds kind of ridiculous, and maybe it is. But in 1967, the U.S. Supreme Court applied a physical presence test for sales and use tax purposes, or use tax collection purposes. In 1992, the U.S. Supreme Court was asked once again by the states to revisit this rule in the context of a use tax collection, what we commonly think of as sales and use taxes. And again, they upheld the sales and use tax physical presence nexus rule. The court was very explicit that it was not answering the question outside of the sales and use tax context, which has engendered years of debate, a lot of cases, a lot of billable hours for lawyers like me as to what the physical presence nexus rule's application ought to be outside of sales and use tax purposes. And the states are largely getting what they want, and they advocate for limiting the physical presence nexus test, the jurisdictional concept, to only sales and use taxes. That's basically where we're ending up. I'm shorthanding it, I'm overspeaking. If the press were here, we'll be okay, right, press?
Right, press?
I'm not conceding the point, because I do think that there's a better case to be made that physical presence, that one jurisdictional constitutional rule ought to be applied across tax types for a lot of purposes, especially in this kind of a context when you have a non-U.S. business doing business in the United States and having that business say to themselves, first of all, I'm stunned that the treaties don't apply. And second of all, not only do I have to learn a different set of jurisdictional rules, I have to learn rules by tax type, really? Does that make any sense? It's, you know, interesting. So I think there's some good rationale for limiting that physical presence test to sales and use taxes, but there's an equally good body of law and rationale to say it should be one jurisdictional standard across tax types. On the sales and use tax side, just finishing off that point, we are here in the great state of New York. We did have, in my opinion, a very weak opinion from the New York Court of Appeals in the Amazon Overstock Nexus case that just came down on the facial constitutional challenge that was brought there. I'm not sure if Overstock's going to seek appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court. We'll see. And then finally, on the sales and use tax side, we do expect the United States Senate, to consider legislation next week as to whether the Congress should intervene and create a relaxed nexus standard, a relaxed remote selling nexus standard, at least in certain circumstances, only for sales and use tax purposes. Okay. Anything on sales and use tax before I jump over into the income tax side of the slide? Okay. On the income tax side of the slide, we generally have rules across the country. Most states are applying what we can call an economic presence nexus test. So it doesn't make a difference if you have people in a state, if your taxpayer or client or what have you, employer, has property in a state. However, if they have customers in a state, then you have an economic presence within that state. So where do you have customers? Well, it used to be pretty easy. In 1993, when Jeffrey was decided by the South Carolina Supreme Court, 1 year after the Quill case from the US Supreme Court, it was pretty easy to see where customers were of Toys R Us, which was the main litigant in that case. But what about with cloud-based services? Where are your customers? Or what about a customer that's in a location that spans the world because they have facilities or distribution centers all over the place? These are the fact patterns that we're wrestling with now. And I think we're seeing the first good bit of litigation as to how this economic presence nexus rule ought to be applied outside of the old economy, now into the new economy. And what we're seeing that play out in the courts. Economic presence nexus is generally the rule for income taxes. So now we have the jurisdictional standard, at least in the eyes of the states. That's their view. So now what? Okay, so once we're within a jurisdiction, what about this treaty protection? What about this notion of permanent establishment? Or US trade or business? Does it apply? Well, almost universally, it does not apply. We have different concepts, again, at the state and local tax level. So we don't apply an effectively connected income concept with a permanent establishment. We don't look to see whether there's a US trade or business. We apply this much more straightforward, in some respects, economic nexus test, knowing that there are certain fact patterns that are difficult. So we're in the jurisdiction. The next level of questions down relate to what kind of reporting requirements do we have within a state for income tax purposes. And here you can really break up the country or the states into two main categories. And there's a lot of subcategories, but we only have 17 minutes and 3 seconds left. So I'm going to do two main categories. One main category is separate reporting states. And all that is very simple to explain. In a separate reporting state like New Jersey, every company that's taxable in that jurisdiction files its own tax return on a standalone basis. No consolidation, no combination, none of that. Separate reporting, separate tax returns. Even if you engage in a lot of intercompany transactions with related parties, even though you may be part of a US consolidated return, you are still filing a standalone separate tax return if you're taxable in that jurisdiction on a standalone basis. That's one major class of states. The other major class of states is combined reporting. In a combined reporting state, once one company steps foot or has jurisdiction in a state using economic presence rules or some other rule, and you're taxable there, you then have to determine the relationship you have with other related parties and whether there's a unitary relationship or not. Now, unitary has no analog for federal tax. There's no concept of unitary law in the federal tax arena or international tax arena. It's a special, separate concept that we state tax lawyers like to talk about. And it's really been defined by the US Supreme Court. They've been giving us the test to apply to determine whether a unitary relationship exists. But in short, it usually exists when a company is jointly owned 50% or more, commonly owned 50% or more, and there's some interaction, flows of value between these companies. So if I'm making cars here in the US and I happen to own a yak farm in Outer Mongolia, even though we're commonly owned, probably not a unitary relationship. But if I own a car company here in the US and I also own a tire company here in the US, commonly owned, and there's probably flows of values between the car company and the tire manufacturer. And then you have everything that lies in between those two type of obvious fact patterns. But unitary analysis engenders a lot of confusion. How does that relate to an inbound taxpayer? Let's assume some company incorporated in the UK now wants to deal with US-based customers. Well, looking at our jurisdictional rules, if you have US-based customers, you probably have an economic nexus here. Okay, step one. Step two is you have to ask yourself that question. Separate reporting state or combined reporting states in those states where you have customers. separate reporting state that UK-based company will file a standalone return. Combined reporting state, that company will file a return that may include its unitary affiliates. That has dramatic consequences. That may look very different than the consolidation rules or other rules that the federal government applies in this context. And it has no bearing on the 80% ownership test that the US government typically uses for consolidation. The next level down of combination is really described in a sub-bullet under the combined reporting one, WE or WW, Water's Edge or Worldwide, Water's Edge or Worldwide combined reporting. It used to be worldwide combined reporting was the standard here in the US years and years ago. So it didn't make a difference if for unitary affiliates, the tire manufacturer was in the US or in another country. If you had that unitary relationship and you were 50% or more commonly owned, you're going to be filing one combined report that includes the unitary income and unitary apportionment factors of that group. Most of the states have moved away from worldwide combined reporting, again, for a lot of good reasons. Very difficult to comply with, difficult to deal with. Much more easier to comply with Water's Edge reporting, which only includes domestic incorporated entities as a general rule. And there's exceptions to all of this. But as a general rule, Water's Edge reporting only includes your domestic unitary affiliates. That does make life a little bit easier for us. So again, UK companies selling into the US, you determine where you're taxable. If it's a Water's Edge combined reporting jurisdiction, you would only include Water's Edge-based companies. Worldwide combined reporting, you would include your worldwide unitary affiliates. Pretty difficult stuff. And then you have other notions here in the US to deal with certain specific fact patterns like 80-20 companies. 80-20 companies are those companies that have 80% or more of their factors outside of the US. Even though they're domestic, you get to exclude them because they resemble really a foreign company in that context. Not a lot of states have 80-20 company concepts or rules anymore. They've been dwindled away because of tax planning, frankly, or difficulty in compliance. Tax haven inclusion. Tax haven inclusion. This makes the state tax lawyers seem like they're trying to sound like international tax lawyers. Well, what happens if you have an affiliate that's domiciled in a country that's listed as a tax haven by the OECD? I think that this is wrong. The state should not be distinguishing between the types of foreign entities. And in fact, I think there's a really good case to challenge them that they cannot do it. Nevertheless, some states are saying, if you're related to a company that's domiciled in a tax haven country as defined by the OECD, then we're gonna treat it as a Water's Edge company. We're gonna domesticate it, basically, and force you to combine it in your Water's Edge combined report. We haven't seen much in the way of litigation on this yet. I'm not quite sure how aggressively the states are auditing for this tax haven concept, but I suspect that we're gonna see more and more as we go, and I suspect there'll be a fair amount of litigation. Now I'm gonna end with the last 10 minutes of my presentation on the meatiest part, and that is tax-based computation. And this is where a lot of the litigation has been, quite frankly, in the inbound context. In 1992, as an example, the US Supreme Court heard a case brought by the Kraft Company, the cheese company. And Kraft made a very interesting argument. Kraft made the following argument. Let's assume that we have two subsidiaries. One subsidiary is a domestic US subsidiary, making cheese or something. And then another subsidiary is, let's say, in the UK, making cheese. In fact, these two subsidiaries are identical, except for the fact one's in the US and one's in the UK. They're identical in every way. They both make the same cheese, even. They both pay dividends to Kraft. But under US tax rules, under the dividends received deduction incorporated in the Internal Revenue Code, the dividends paid from the domestic subsidiary qualifies for a DRD, a dividends received deduction. The dividends paid by that UK subsidiary does not qualify for a dividends received deduction. And of course, I think many of you would say, duh, there's good reasons for that. It's DRDs are to prevent double layers of taxation. The domestic subsidiary was already subject to US tax, so subjecting that dividend, that payer's dividend to tax again would be double tax. You should have a DRD. However, in the UK subsidiary example, earning income outside of the US and then paying dividends to a US company there should not be a DRD would be the argument, and that's why it doesn't qualify under the Internal Revenue Code for a dividends received deduction. It hasn't been subjected to the U.S. tax quite yet, and therefore one layer of tax is appropriate here. No DRD. Makes sense, right? Well, Kraft made a pretty interesting and successful argument, handled actually by Jerry Libin at Sutherland,
oh, really?
Believe it or not. Yep. Jerry successfully argued that that conformity that the state was making to the Internal Revenue Code, mirroring the treatment, was discriminatory. A state was actually providing an incentive to invest in domestic subsidiaries and a disincentive for investing in non-U.S. subsidiaries by treating the DRDs differently, or the dividends differently, and only applying the DRD to domestic dividends. Now, the state made a pretty interesting argument. Hey, we're not intending to discriminate here. We're merely conforming to the Internal Revenue Code. We're not trying to do anything outrageous. We're just conforming. No intent to discriminate. And in fact, they argued there was no real discrimination, too. Well, the court didn't see it that way. The court held that there was discrimination. And in fact, the fact that conformity was the rationale didn't help. And the fact that there was no intent to discriminate didn't help. Discriminatory. So as a result of that, the states had a decision to make. Give everybody a DRD or give nobody a DRD. Most of the states who had that mirroring conforming DRD treatment, it gave everybody DRDs. But not all the time. Generally, most of the time, non-U.S. dividends paid to a U.S. taxpayer qualify for DRDs in many states, not all the states. That's dividends. What about royalties? One could argue a foreign company paying royalties to a U.S. taxpayer should be receiving that same kind of treatment, especially if the royalty payer was included in a U.S. Water's Edge combined report where the royalty wasn't being taxed. It was eliminated in the combined report. But that foreign royalty payer paying into the U.S., not eliminated, in fact, subject to U.S. state tax in most of the states. Taxpayers have challenged this over and over and over again and have largely been unsuccessful. Couple successes, less successes, I would say, more defeats. So taxpayers have said, well, listen, if you're going to tax that royalty income, you should give me factor representation for that non-U.S. company, or you shouldn't tax it at all. And it's been tough. It's been a tough road to hoe for that. Expense disallowance, also a sub-bullet on this slide. Expense disallowance. The states got preoccupied with intercompany transactions related to interest and intangibles. There's been a bunch of litigation over the past 20 years with Delaware holding companies, Nevada holding companies, other type of intercompany lending, creating state tax benefits. And what the states have done, they really used a sledgehammer to kill a flea. I mean, they created these very draconian expense disallowance rules that say, if you make a payment of interest or a payment in relation to an intangible between related parties, no deduction. No deduction. We don't care if it was a cash sweep account. We don't care if it was an intangible payment that pre-existed being commonly owned. We're seeing those fact patterns a lot. We don't care. Any of those intercompany payments, no deductions, unless you can qualify for some very limited exceptions. What about in the foreign context? Well, one of the exceptions that many states have put in and putting in place this draconian expense disallowance regime is what we call a foreign treaty exception. If the payee has a domicile in a country that has a comprehensive treaty with the United States, then you have an exception from expense disallowance and you get to deduct the payment. All right, not so bad. But again, why are we limiting this treatment to only those countries where the U.S. has a foreign or comprehensive, whatever that means, foreign treaty? Not so sure. I'm not so sure why, especially as more and more U.S. businesses are doing or opening up operations, creating subsidiaries and business relationships with companies in Asia. That's the common fact pattern that we're seeing. And some countries we have treaties with, obviously, some countries we don't. And you can have the identical business relationship with two subsidiaries, again, based upon country incorporation, very, very different treatment. And in my view, very difficult to justify. I have a hard time with this treating foreign countries differently based upon how the U.S. government has decided to treat them. Because general, as I haven't seen a fact pattern yet where a company has gone to a specific country to save state taxes back home. Haven't seen it. Maybe you guys have. I'm still looking for it. And then the light bulb will go off and I'll say, okay, now I get it. I'll back off. Until then, I'm going to continue to rail against it. So we have this dividends received deduction treatment. We have this royalty treatment. We also have this expense disallowance treatment. There is another area that is probably worth spending a couple minutes on, especially since, again, we're here in New York. Now, I mentioned before that states generally aren't confined by the U.S. treaties with other countries. But as a practical matter, there is a lot of benefit. And there's a case cited in some slide called Reuters that emanates from here in New York. And in Reuters, it really brought to light this issue. Suppose a non-U.S. company steps foot in the U.S. or does business here in the U.S. or establishes nexus here in the U.S. and now is subject to U.S. state taxes. First of all, a lot of people are surprised because you have to then spend the next 2 hours describing why the treaties don't protect that company from U.S. state taxes. Nobody wants to believe you, but take my word for it, it's true. Save yourself the 2 hours. Then you have to determine how do you compute your tax return. Well, in a lot of states, Massachusetts I'll pick on, Massachusetts will say, well, you do have to file a tax return, but you look to your federal starting point to begin your Massachusetts tax computation. And your federal starting point is zero because that company maybe does not have a permanent establishment in the U.S. So there is no federal taxable income. And because there is zero federal taxable income, there's no computation for that state. So one could argue it's economically equivalent almost to being treaty protected because that result is flowing down to that Massachusetts tax return. Again, a bit of a generalization, but that's the position of some states. Not here in New York. In New York, Reuters stepped foot into the US, established a nexus here in New York, had to file a New York tax return, and argued in part, we shouldn't have to pay New York tax, we're treaty protected. And even if we did, we have a zero starting point because we have no federal taxable income. You know what New York said? New York being very creative, and they won on this in litigation. Well, guess what we have for you? We have an opportunity for you to create a what we'll call a pro forma federal taxable income return, a federal tax return, as if you were not treaty protected. And then based upon that pro forma made up fantasy tax return, we're now going to compute your New York taxable income and impose tax on you. So the question before the court was, should a taxpayer have to compute a fantasy federal tax return for purposes of conforming and then doing your state tax return? And the New York court said yes. Be careful here in New York. If any company steps foot, any company has nexus here in New York, it's going to be a very interesting discussion.
So don't
to have
use a branch
that.
Is what you're saying.
I'm sorry?
Don't use a branch.
Create a subsidiary. I mean, that's generally the planning idea is, you know, like planning 101 is, you know, create a U.S. subsidiary and have that company file all your state tax returns. And that's what I'm sure Peter advises his clients. So that Reuters case is one that we often talk about and advise our clients to be wary about. A lot of states have not addressed this point, so you have risk in some states that have not addressed it. Some states have, many states have not. Finally, sourcing of income. So, you know, the state taxable way of slicing the pie among jurisdictions is very difficult. We don't do the credit, the fancy credit stuff that Peter and his colleagues do. We apportion our income. We determine our big bucket of taxable income. Then we multiply it by an apportionment formula, and out the other side comes apportioned income to that jurisdiction. Apportionment formulas are generally focused now on sales factors. In-state sales divided by all your sales. That creates a fraction. You multiply that fraction by your taxable income, and that gives you your state apportioned income. Apportionment formulas in federal taxable income and this worldwide combined reporting, really, when they intersect like this, it's very, very difficult to comply with right now. Because how you determine that top part of the fraction, what we'll call the sales factor numerator, the top part of the fraction, getting difficult to comply with for service-based companies, especially those that are cloud-based. And to the extent you're dealing with a company, and Peter and I were talking about a client of his that's doing business on the internet, in the cloud, and it's non-US based, but it uses servers and infrastructure all throughout the US, sourcing that sale for purposes of that sales factor numerator, very difficult to do. We could spend another 2 hours or six more classes together okay. just talking about that. And with that, I think I am out of time. So thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you. That was excellent. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Wonderful. Excellent. Excellent. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Most of today's program so far has been focused on portfolio and commercial investment in the United States, but now we're going to turn the focus to a very important topic, and that is the U.S. taxation with respect to U.S. real property when there's a foreign investor. Not unlike many countries around the world, the United States is keenly focused to assure that the U.S. will tax gains on disposition of interest in U.S. real property by foreign persons under what is known as the Foreign Investment in U.S. Real Property Tax Act of 1980, or FIRPTA. Our speakers today on this topic include Ameek Ponda and Peter Genz, two recognized experts in this field. Now, the speakers are going to focus not only on the technical rules, but they're also going to be talking about tax planning structures with respect to inbound investment in U.S. real property, including through real estate investment trusts. Ameek is a tax partner with Sullivan and Worcester in Boston, where a significant part of its focus is, in fact, on REIT planning. Ameek is an adjunct professor at the Boston University Law School's Tax LLM program, where he teaches courses on several topics, including international tax, RICs and REITs, and financial products. Ameek also has taught partnership taxation at Harvard Law School as a lecturer on law. A frequent speaker on taxation topics, Ameek is also the author of numerous articles, including most recently the article entitled, How Much Gain Would a REIT Defer If a REIT Could Defer a Gain? It sounds a bit like a Dr. Seuss book, I think. Perhaps with a pop-up version. Peter Genz is a tax partner with King & Spalding. Peter's practice concentrates on corporate partnership and real estate tax matters with particular emphasis on tax planning relating to public and private REITs and investment by tax-exempt organizations and foreign investment in U.S. real property. Peter is a prolific speaker and author on various aspects of foreign investment in U.S. real property. Peter chairs the REIT subcommittee of the Real Estate Committee of the ABA Section on Taxation. Gentlemen.
Thank you, Larry, for that kind introduction. Ameek, pleasure to be up here with you. I didn't realize I should be calling you professor, but I will from now on. We're going to try to move quickly from basic principles and get to more complicated matters. Have you got a clicker for the slides?
Yeah.
You're going to take charge?
Sure, I'll do that.
Just to start with a brief overview of the portfolio interest exemption, which all of us know, but never hurts to repeat of some of these points. To get interest out of the U.S. tax-free, you either got to have a treaty or you got to have the portfolio interest exemption. And the portfolio interest exemption requires a number of things. Debt's got to be in registered form. Doesn't apply to contingent interest. The recipient can't own actually or constructively 10% or more of the voting stock of a payor corporation or 10% of the capital or profits interest of a payor partnership. Not available to a bank lending in the ordinary course of business, a foreign bank. Also not available to a CFC, a controlled foreign corporation, if it's receiving interest from a related party. I recently ran across this, never thought I'd see it in my career, but actually saw a Cayman feeder fund that had admitted a foreign captive company that happened to have a domestic parent that caused the feeder to become a CFC, which tainted the feeder with respect to getting interest on portfolio debt from a U.S. company down below. So beware your subscription agreements that make sure that they cover those kind of details that you don't have investors down below, up above your structure, who may have a domestic parent and trigger a CFC rule. Obviously, if you're in a lending trader business, your interest is going to be ECI and you're not worried about portfolio. Treaties will provide for an exemption for interest, typically, very often, but contingent interest probably gets subject to the rate applicable to dividends, which may be 15%. An example here on slide 171 is the fifth protocol of the Canadian treaty, provides for that treatment. Section 892 is another exemption for interest. I guess I said earlier there were only two. There happens to be a third if you happen to be a sovereign wealth fund. And you can meet the requirements of 892, then the interest is exempt. It cannot be received from a controlled commercial entity, cannot be received by a controlled commercial entity. I know Patrick Fenn's going to speak more about this sort of subject in the next session. We'll touch on it more here. It's almost impossible to avoid given the amount of foreign government money coming into the U.S. and trying to figure out how to take maximum advantage of 892 when you have it in your hip pocket. Taxation of rental real estate operating income, we all know those basic rules. Rental income is ECI. There is an exception under recognizing some old cases for net leased real property, and those cases have taken on new prominence with the 1411 Medicare, so-called Medicare tax. You now hear the IRS warning you every day that if you're trying to avoid the tax by claiming you're active in a trade or business, and that income should not be subject to the passive income tax, to the Medicare tax, they're now saying you may not have a trade or business if it's real estate. And that's kind of news to me because I've always thought most leased real estate did constitute a trade or business. Unless you had a triple net lease, one-off property, nothing else, then you go back to Imodio and some of the old cases. But the IRS has been bringing this up at every chance it gets in the Medicare tax area, warning you to consider whether you've got a trade or business when you're leasing real estate. It was never a big issue on my radar, but we may have to start thinking about it. If you're not in a trade or business, you got a 30% gross basis tax, but you can make a treaty or code-based net basis election if you want to take deductions, which you normally would. Now you turn to FERPTA, and FERPTA is an overlay on this scheme, which applies to gain from the sale of U.S. real property interests. It ensures that they are subject to tax as effectively connected income. The sale is subject to 10% withholding. Sale of partnership interests that own U.S. RPIs are treated as a U.S. RPI itself, and subject to full withholding if you've got a so-called 50-90 partnership, which means a large concentration of U.S. RPIs in the entity as defined in the regs. Remember that when you're selling a partnership interest in a U.S. RPI partnership, it's often very much the case that the non-U.S. investor thinks he's going to see 10% withholding against his cash proceeds. But if you've got debt allocable to your partnership interest, it's 10% of that number, too. I've seen many an occasion where that was simply overlooked in planning by the client, sometimes the advisors, but usually it's just they're thinking they're going to see 10% of their cash gone. If you don't meet the 50-90 test, there's no withholding on a sale of a partnership interest that has U.S. RPIs, but obviously you still have a substantive tax to the extent of the gain is attributable to U.S. RPIs or to the extent it's attributable to trade or business assets. And next slide deals with pension trusts. Always remember that if you've got a foreign pension trust that happens to be a trust for tax purposes, then we're now talking about a tax rate not 35%, but rather 20%. Or potentially 25% on unrecaptured 1250 rate gain. And there are a couple private letter rulings on this slide you can look at where the IRS ruled that a trust, foreign pension trust of one type or another, was in fact classified as such. Now, I've seen pension trusts try to flip it around and argue they're corporations when they want to have a 332 liquidation and bring ECI assets into conjunction with NOLs that are ECI NOLs. So, you know, I've seen people try to play both sides of this game, and in some cases it simply may be unclear.
And Pete, the background to all this is that these foreign pension trusts are not going to qualify under 401A and 501A as tax-exempt pension trusts because they don't meet the domestication requirement in the statute.
Right, yeah. Exactly. We note on the next slide that a foreign government is treated as a foreign person for FERPTA purposes. So lest there be any doubt about it, it's in the 897-9T regs. There's also a reg buried in there, which I was happy to find one day when we were on the other side of the United Nations in the transaction. They were telling us that they're not subject to FERPTA, and which we believed, but no one would give us any cite There happens to be in 9T of the 897 regs an international organization. FERP just doesn't apply. But it was odd. We were all thinking we knew the answer, and even their counsel thought they knew the answer, but no one would tell us why. That's the reason. Ameek was mentioning to me the other day that he thought if you had a non-U.S. Exempt organization that would meet our U.S. exempt requirements, what happens there?
That's right. I mean, our view is that for such an organization, if you meet 501c3 or 501c4, and that's a complicated inquiry, including maybe the need or desire for a determination letter, but 501s, C3 and C4 will trump FERPTA, meaning an exempt organization is exempt on capital gain. FERPTA is just capital gain.
Don't run into it very often. That's certainly the case. Next slide, participating mortgage loans. I guess I should start by saying that a regular mortgage loan itself is not a FERPTA interest. It is not a USRPI, which is why mortgage REITs, for example, typically are not U.S. real property holding companies, unless they happen to hold some direct real estate interests. But if you've got a participating loan with an equity kicker feature, it is classified as a USRPI. But the collection of the kicker interest is not a disposition that causes gain from the disposition of a USRPI. That's just interest. And so there's an example in the regs that makes it clear that you can collect kicker interest and rely on treaty exemptions. Now, again, if it's contingent, you may not have it, and you won't have necessarily portfolio interest either. And if you sell a participating loan to a third party, you've sold a USRPI, you got withholding, FERPTA withholding. You can go for a FERPTA withholding certificate, as many of us know, to get reduced rates of withholding. You'll sometimes see that done in the REIT context, where a REIT is paying a FERPTA capital gain distribution to a foreign pension trust. A REIT is required to withhold at 35%, but suppose the foreign pension says it's actually 20% for me because I think I'm a trust. You can go get a FERPTA withholding certificate from the service center, and they will confirm for you that you're entitled to that lower rate. And then if that's provided to the REIT, you can move on and get a sort of a rational answer. Right now, the statute doesn't recognize a lower rate than 35. All right, let's talk about U.S. real property holding companies on slide 179. Normally, gain from the sale of U.S. corporate stock exempt from tax when recognized by a non-U.S. person. If it's a U.S. real property holding company or was at any time during a look-back period, a five-year look-back period, then it is treated, the shares are treated as a USRPI. Well, how do you know you got one? That's quite a challenge in practice. It can be. Sometimes it's very simple. Most equity REITs, virtually everyone, is going to be a U.S. RIPIC by definition. And the test is that the USRPIs at their value equal or exceed the sum of the USRPIs plus foreign real estate interests plus trade or business assets. So if you trip that fraction and hit the 50% mark, at any time during the look-back period, the shares are tainted with USRPI status. Now, the presumption is that shares of a U.S. corporation are USRPIs unless the selling shareholder gets a statement from the corporation signed under penalties of perjury that the shares are not a USRPI. And by the way, if you're selling a private USRPI, you got a buyer now who has to worry about withholding and establishing that that corporation's shares are not a USRPI. So it's not just you and the company, it's you and the buyer if it's a private company. This determination, as I said, may be very easy, but I've seen a number of cases now in my career where it is extremely difficult. And I've got one case in mind that was a particular problem where we had a company, a portfolio company and a private equity fund that happened to have a ton of franchises and a ton of leasehold interests. Those were below market leaseholds, were worth a lot of money. And those happened to be USRPIs. So while this business had a ton of goodwill, it had brand names, it had everything you can think of that goes with a sort of going business, it had a ton of real estate value potentially. And the values of those assets can go up or down during the look back period. Now, nobody had arranged to get a commitment from that company to provide a FERPTA statement. Nobody had done it. Now what happens? when you go to sell and the company, the portfolio company, is asked and nobody's prepared them, they haven't been doing valuations, they now got to figure out who's going to pay for this, are we going to get an accounting firm in to value everything, and what kind of a letter can you get? Will they say it's more likely than not? We think it's, we believe, but we're not certain. Who knows? My point is that when you've got a situation like this and you've got a non-U.S. investor who's a direct owner or a fund sponsor partnership that's got 1446 withholding to worry about, you got to start thinking early on at the time the investment's made about how do I prove the company's not a U.S. RIPIC when I go to sell it years down the road. And the buyer will keep you honest because they're going to demand that statement from the company in order not to withhold 10%. That I've seen become a real brouhaha. Publicly traded exception, we've got a 5% exception if you've held less than 5% actually constructively in a publicly traded U.S. RIPIC, which would include a publicly traded REIT. You don't have a FIRPTA tax when you sell the shares. You've also got, finally, a cleansing exception, what has come to be known as the cleansing exception, which is when a U.S. company that's U.S. RIPIC purges all of its U.S. real property interests in fully taxable transactions and liquidates. When it does that, it's recognizing gain, general utilities gain, if you will, at the corporate level, and the drafters of the regs and the statute said, okay, we'll let them off the hook at the shareholder level. Once it's cleansed, the shares cease to be U.S. RPIs. And you don't have a second FIRPTA tax at the shareholder level. And remember, you also don't have a dividend tax because liquidating distributions aren't dividends. So the exit, if you've sold everything in a U.S. co, in a fully taxable transaction, the exit at the shareholder level is clean. Now, if it's a REIT, does the cleansing exception apply to a REIT? Literally, it does on its face. I wouldn't bet on it if you got a foreign-controlled REIT where you're avoiding all FIRPTA tax, both at the REIT level and at the shareholder level. We'll talk about that a little bit more. And I'll turn it over to Ameek now to get into REITs.
Sure. Thanks, folks. So before we dive into REITs, which have a special status both under the tax code and under FIRPTA, just to set a little bit of a framework for how we think about this, the first thing is there's a tension in cross-border real estate taxation in terms of thinking of real estate. Is it a portfolio type play, right? Lease financing is like loan financing, or is it more like foreign direct investment in an active trader business? Some of that might depend on the property, triple net lease versus multi-tenanted properties. Some of it may depend on the level of investment that a foreigner has in the particular entity or in the real estate itself. So that tension exists under FIRPTA, but then it's increased when you start talking about the REIT rules, because what the REIT rules represent is a single layer of tax, right? So in that sense, they might feel like some to partnerships, but they're not really partnerships. They're not flow-throughs in the classical sense. They're a modified pass-through, and REITs operate as a blocker, and they don't block all FIRPTA consequences, but they can block some FIRPTA consequences or ECI-type consequences, which is why they're so popular when they can be used. A second observation in this area is a lot of people in the cross-border real estate space, the inbound, will use REITs, but it's not a panacea. It's not right for everyone. If you think of a REIT as a hammer, you know, not every problem is a nail. Clients may think that, but not every problem is a nail. Where possible, REITs make sense, but they don't make sense in every situation. The third thing is the trend over the years has been that sellers are increasingly willing to take, sellers, investors who one day on exit will be sellers, are increasingly willing to take on and get into situations that are complicated, both as a matter of structure in terms of what the ultimate exit must look like, as well as the ongoing reporting obligations. So, you know, if you dial back maybe 10, 15 years, people didn't want to have U.S. tax nexus and U.S. tax filing obligations in respect of their real estate. There's more appetite for non-residents, whether it's individuals or corporations, to incur those kinds of tax filing obligations in exchange for a lower effective cash tax rate. And then similarly, just as sellers have moved into more complicated structures, some of them involving REITs, on the ultimate exit down the road, you find buyers who are willing to transact and not demand or insist on doing an asset deal, a dirt deal, but willing to buy shares of a company that owns the real estate, and in fact willing to take all the associated risk with that. Was REIT qualification good in the, you know, on seller's watch, that kind of thing. So there's reasons for that as well, including maybe over the last 10 years, the REIT rules are moving in a direction of you make a small mistake, you go to the guillotine, right? versus intermediate sanctions where the punishment fits the crime. So you make a small mistake under the REIT rules and there are intermediate sanctions which don't cost you REIT status necessarily.
We still feel like we've gone to the guillotine.
Yeah, well, some of us have been to the guillotine.
I want to make that very clear.
So in terms of the unique status of REITs, again, a REIT is a company that meets organizational income, asset, and distribution requirements, and in exchange for that is able to get a deduction for the dividends it pays to its common and preferred shareholders. So it's the classic, not only is my interest on my debt deductible, but it's that holy grail, the dividends on my equity are deductible as well. Another big thing you find in this cross-border space is that REITs make a lot of sense, not just for foreigners. They make sense for the domestic investors, high net worth individuals, tax exempts. REITs are a blocker for these folks as well. High net worth individuals will get a 1099, not a bunch of K-1s from a bunch of different states. The tax exempts will get a UBIT blocker. And then it lines up with what foreign investors are also looking for, and in terms of a partial FIRPTA blocker, and then a structural exemption from state taxation. REITs are one of the few examples where source states cede taxation jurisdiction to the residents of the investor. In terms of the way ordinary dividends are taxed, years ago it used to be taxed just like any other dividend, 30% cross-border withholding, and treaty articles would, if they generally reduce dividends, they would similarly reduce REIT dividends. This is apropos of the comment that REITs are not really so much a flow-through, they're just a corporation that gets a deduction for dividends paid. Over the last 15 or so years, most treaties now have special rules and special articles for whether there will be reduced source taxation on ordinary REIT dividends.
One point here, yeah. That it's not uncommon in newer treaties now to see that a non-individual that owns less than 10% or 10% or less of a REIT can claim the 15% rate on withholding as opposed to a 30% rate if the REIT is diversified. Now, what does that mean? When you look at the technical explanations of the treaty, you get very little guidance, but basically most of them will say no single interest in real estate is more than 10% of the value of the total assets. And what happens if a parent REIT has 11 subsidiary REITs, and each one of the subsidiaries is a one-off property REIT? In my view, that ought to meet the diversification test, even though you don't have direct real estate interests in the parent REIT. I've had that structure come up with German insurance companies for whom a U.S. REIT is attractive under their quota rules, their regulatory rules, and they're going to want to be able to sell domestically controlled REIT shares as well, which means setting up a bunch of one-off REITs, and you may not be able to. The question is it diversified? And I think the answer should be yes, but you won't find the statement to that effect.
So, and these articles are all over the place under the treaties. They're all worded a little differently, and it's in the model treaty as well. But again, the point is that ordinary dividends are treated really as dividends first, and it takes something special in the statute or in the treaty articles to treat a REIT ordinary dividend as something other than a regular dividend from any old C corp. That means, for example, that if there's a structural exemption in place for the recipient, such as a Section 892 sovereign wealth fund, they can, at least as a starting point, receive that dividend tax-free. Similarly, the rules for hybrid entities and the treaty architecture we have under 894C in terms of who beneficially derives the income, it applies in the REIT context the exact same way. And then there are some treaties, Canada is an example, the Dutch is another, there are some others, where foreign pension plans, these were bargains that were, you know, these were benefits that were bargained for by those countries, that their pension plans should be treated like US-style 401 pension plans, at least as to interest and dividend income. And that extends to ordinary REIT dividends as well. The real sticking point in terms of the REIT pass-through regime or the REIT single level of tax regime is 897H1, which has been in the code for a very, very long time, but there are still no regulations. And we're all sort of left wondering in terms of how it applies and what the allocation rule is in terms of which dividends it tags.
But well, basically, I think that's not totally true. We've had withholding regulations authorized by any statute.
Right. We've had withholding regulations, yeah. But the underlying substantive rule is still a mystery. And the withholding regulations aren't a model of clarity or for a whole variety of reasons. But there's an under-inclusive element, an over-inclusive element, the way 897H one can work, as well as the withholding regulations. But this is one of those cases where some of the dividends that a REIT is paying out is going to be treated as tagged under FIRPTA as effectively connected income. And the trick is to either plan around that, I hope that doesn't happen, or in the case of publicly traded REITs, there's an exception for a less than 5% shareholder. Again, going back to the thesis that portfolio investments in real estate will get treated differently than foreign direct investment in real estate. The rule is also tiered so that if you have a parent REIT and a subsidiary REIT, and the subsidiary REIT pays out an 897 H1 type income, then that sort of gets tagged at the parent level such that when the parent pays it out to its ultimate shareholders, the taint continues. So you can't cleanse an 897 H1 problem through using tiers of REITs. There's also a wash sale rule, and probably by its very existence, it doesn't happen anymore, which is that if there are foreigners who have an impending H1 dividend coming up and they decide that their best strategy is to sell their shares, stay out of the shares for a while, and then buy back in, if you do that within a 60-day period, then your income and cash gets recharacterized as though you actually received that effectively connected income.
And filing a tax return. And just my only point on this is, your instinct is to tell you that this is a public REIT issue only. No, it applies to private REITs, and you can get bit. I've seen plans to sell, avoid a FIRPTA tax, buy back later. Right. Be careful about wash sale.
Yeah, and I mean, in some sense, we have these, holding period requirements, compact, these kinds of things. It's a very similar issue. How long do you need to be in or out of a stock to be considered not in violation of the larger principles of the statute? There is a withholding regime to back up H1 as well. It is now more firmly grounded in the statute. There have been regs for a very long time, but the regs are over-inclusive and under-inclusive for a whole variety of reasons that people have commented on. The domestically controlled REIT exception is a very important element of the statute. It's a cornerstone of planning in cross-border real estate. The rationale for it is not entirely clear, which makes it also hard to reason from first principles as to, will this arrangement qualify for the domestically controlled REIT exception? Will this arrangement not qualify? But the basic idea is that if less than 50% of the REIT is owned by foreigners in a five-year look-back period, then cross sales, not necessarily liquidations, we'll come to that, but a shareholder selling shares to a buyer, that can be free of a FIRPTA taint, even though the REIT under normal circumstances would be considered a U.S. real property holding corporation. And if you're a U.S. real property holding corporation, sort of the only normal out you have is the 5% publicly traded exception. But if you're a REIT, you get more than that. You get this domestically controlled REIT exception, which applies to public and private REITs, and it's much larger. You could sell a 40% position in a domestically controlled REIT and not face FIRPTA on the sale of that USRPHC. The scope of the exemption and how it interacts with, it's absolutely clear it works on a cross-purchase, cross-sale, how it works in a 302B redemption, how it works in a 331 liquidating distribution. That's been the subject of a lot of controversy, most particularly around this notice, which sets a large interorum effect around these issues, but not a lot of guidance on some of the technical details. Part of understanding the domestically controlled exception is, what if you have foreigners who own a domestic entity and the domestic entity then owns shares in the REIT? Do those shares count as part of domestic ownership, or do they count as part of foreign ownership? And again, we have some guidance in this area, but there are a lot of unanswered questions. Most practitioners think, and a private letter ruling confirms, that if the intervening U.S. entity is a C corporation, then even though that C corporation may be ultimately owned by foreigners, including a foreign parent, a sole owner, that the shares owned by that C corporation in the REIT count towards domestic ownership status. So the feel is that what we're getting at is not whether the foreigner has ultimate voting control or that kind of control over the REIT, but whether enough of the REIT is going to be sort of subject to U.S. tax because there's a U.S. taxpayer in the picture. And as I said, a private letter ruling confirms that. You could take this too far and sort of posit cases where a parent REIT, public or private, owns shares in a subsidiary REIT. And then the subsidiary REIT maybe would say, well, gee, I'm not a U.S. real property interest. Shares in my REIT are not U.S. real property interest because I'm owned by a U.S. taxpayer, a parent REIT. And then the parent REIT is not a U.S. real property holding corporation because the investment in the subsidiary REIT is not a U.S. real property interest. So this kind of tiering, there's questions of whether you look through a parent REIT to its foreign owners, if any, in deciding whether the subsidiary REIT is or is not a domestically controlled REIT. And then these statuses tier up and they tier down. And there's just a lot of unanswered questions in this area.
I mean, the bottom line on this is if you try to have non-U.S. person, parent REIT forming a sub-REIT and claim the sub-REIT's domestically controlled, you can come up with a great argument on the face of the statute. The problem is there's no tax advisor out there that will go with you on it. They just won't go with you. They just think this looks too bad. And in my experience, you're not going to see anybody structure it that way. And yet, it's hard to tell a client exactly why it doesn't work.
It's also hard in the case of a public REIT to know who the ultimate indirect foreign owners are. So there are some practical and administrative problems with this as well. So this notice is, if the domestically controlled REIT exception is a cornerstone of cross-border real estate, inbound real estate planning here, this notice is the bane of people's existence because it covers a whole variety of situations that people were, prior to the issuance of the notice, more optimistic on. For example, a REIT that sold all its assets and liquidated and returned money to the foreign investors, foreign and domestic investors. But the notice has an interim effect that would appear to cover not just ordinary operating dividends, but liquidating distributions, 302B style redemptions, et cetera. The notice also has a clarification, if you will, in the view of the Treasury and the Internal Revenue Service, that FIRPTA 897, at least as to H1 type dividends, trumps Section 892. And that's the point there regarding Notice 2007-55. FIRPTA trumps 892 in the view of the Treasury. One of the things that people talk about, again, the line of scrimmage moves a lot in this area in terms of what is a portfolio real estate investment and what is foreign direct investment. And people have been talking about, and maybe it'll happen. Predictions are dangerous, especially about the future, right? So we're waiting to see what happens to Notice 2007-55. Pete, you had a thought on the administration's proposal?
Yeah. Let me first give a thought on 2007-55. We've been waiting a long time for somebody to rethink that notice, which was only a few pages long and really had no technical analysis, and has, in my judgment, very, very significant technical problems with the concept that's been adopted, which namely that liquidating and redemption distributions are subject to 897H1 and therefore trigger FIRPTA gain. The biggest problem of which is it's very hard to attribute gain to a distribution that isn't income. To a REIT shareholder, it's a payment in exchange for stock under 331. That's absolutely clear. It's not a dividend. It's not income. The existing withholding regs attribute FIRPTA taint to a capital gain dividend. We know that's an amount that's taxable. You can assign a FIRPTA character to something that you know is income. But when you're getting a payment in exchange for stock, there's no precedent in our tax system anywhere for assigning a FIRPTA gain component to something that isn't income to start with. It's an amount realized on shares.
Right, it's quite a stretch. The Treasury's view is 897H1 is written broadly to cover distributions attributable to FIRPTA gain. So that could cover 302, that could cover.
And they think it's a loophole. But my point is that you've got domestically controlled REIT stock sales taking place now of necessity, because that's the only game left. You can't sell the property and liquidate, you'll trigger FIRPTA gain. You're forced to do a stock sale that nobody wants. The buyer doesn't. You don't want it because you may be taking a haircut on the purchase price. So what option do you have today with the notice out there? Is a stock sale is what you're looking for, and fighting with your investors about whether to do one and on what terms will you do it. The buyer comes in and looks at REIT due diligence. They're concerned. They want opinions. Indemnifications. The transaction is not a simple transaction, although it can get done, is getting done. So there had been, at one point in time, some movement we thought that the Treasury might be rethinking this. I don't know where that stands today, and I'm not unduly optimistic. But at the same time, we have some ray of light on FERPTA, which is Obama's budget proposals, the 2014 proposals that came out, include a FERPTA proposal. Significantly, it is not housed in the international tax reform section of those proposals. It is housed in the infrastructure segment. And the idea would be to now provide for treatment for foreign pension funds investing in USRPIs. It's not just infrastructure, it's any USRPIs, that parallels the treatment of US tax exempts. It doesn't use those words, but the idea and the explanation is we want to provide similar treatment. And if tax exempts generally don't pay tax, and I understand they can under the UBTI rules if it's debt financed and you don't have an exception, okay, now you go to the non-US investor and provide similar treatment. The Green Book does not mention sovereign wealth funds, although many are pension funds or have pension funds as a component. My understanding is that that was intentional, that the, right now SWIFTs are not on their radar for this relief. I don't know, I've not heard seen that publicly stated, but I have heard it. But the language at least is flexible enough that it could be construed to include government pensions as well. I'm not sure why you would want to disincentivize that source of money. The revenue estimate on this, by the way, is about $2 billion over 10 years, so there is a number to it. Whether we're going to see anything like this depends in part on whether we have comprehensive tax reform. You know, Congressman Camp has made it his mission to, he's got a couple years left to, you know, in his term to do something on this. If we saw a bill, reasonable chance maybe this might get in it. But right now, who knows? It's nice to talk about.
So in terms of planning, again, you have to sort of, and we have pictures which we'll get to very soon. The point being that if you introduce cross-border money through a REIT, whether that's a sovereign wealth fund, some other kind of pension trust, individual investors, corporate, you can, at least as to sort of normal net operating income from real estate, you know, your rent minus your interest, your depreciation, your management fees, et cetera, pay that out as REIT dividends, which will be at most subject to 30% withholding, but often reduced under a treaty, maybe even exempted under a treaty. And then when it comes time to sell the property, you can plan for an exit that involves a sale of the domestically controlled shares in the REIT. Now, there's a couple of things going on here, that sellers are increasingly comfortable entering into this, and many promoters are willing to promise, or you know, strongly promise, maybe even ironclad promise, the foreign money that there won't be an asset sale. Because if you have an asset sale, that will trigger a FERPTA taint through H1, which there's just no getting rid of, and then the foreign investor has to pay tax on that.
I mean, but if I've got a $15 million multifamily apartment property, how much luck am I going to have getting the buyer of that asset to pick up a REIT when they may never have even heard of what a REIT is?
Right, not for $15 million, but when you start talking about $100 million, maybe even a little lower, you can get buyers who are very motivated and very interested in that sort of structure. And part of what's going on here is because a REIT is a modified pass-through, a buyer can get a stepped-up basis even though they're buying shares. There's ways to do that and ways to engineer that are deeply technical inside the REIT rules. The sellers can sell their REIT shares free of FERPTA, okay? And buyers can get increasingly comfortable that during seller's watch, the REIT was operated like it should have been. There's increasing sophistication out there in terms of what you need to do and how you need to behave to be a REIT. And also, as we described earlier, there are now intermediate sanctions under the REIT rules such that the punishment fits the crime and you don't go to the guillotine for a small infraction. So as a result of that, we're seeing more and more investors who will one day be sellers willing to entertain REIT structures, as well as the idea that the only sale and only exit they're going to have is a sale of REIT shares. And we're seeing buyers who are not demanding a haircut or balking at the idea that they have to buy the structure, if you will, the REIT, rather than buy the dirt, buy the asset. Again, they can get their basis step up without any additional tax at the REIT level or the buyer or the seller, and they can get comfortable that the target was operated as a REIT during the relevant period.
Keep in mind the buyer and their ultimate ownership has to accommodate REIT qualification throughout the year when you do this sale. If you're relying on the DC REIT exception, it's got to be a good REIT both before you sell and after you sell through the end of that year.
Right.
So their ownership has got to be good. And if they have non-US investors up above their structure, if it's a fund buyer, you're passing the trash to them.
So the thing
they may not want your trash.
The thing about REIT is it's not like an S corporation where when you blow the status, then you're an S during the first part of the year, and then you're something else, a C during the REIT status is for the entire taxable year. It's binary. Either you were a REIT for that entire period or you weren't. And so part of the seller's strategy is they need to sell a domestically controlled REIT. That means they need covenants that the buyer will operate it as a REIT for however long the buyer is obligated or wants to keep it around. Pete, do you want to talk quickly about the branch profits tax?
Right, and I know you just heard about the branch tax in the preceding presentation. We won't spend but a minute on it. But bottom line is that the disaster in the world that I practice in, there are always disasters, and there are a myriad of disasters, but this one I always worry about, which is sticking a non-U.S. investor, not just with a 35% tax, but a branch tax on top of it, which can go as high, effectively, as 54.5%. The branch tax, thankfully, does not apply to sales of shares of a U.S. RIPIC, to the gain from the sale of U.S. RIPIC shares. That's just an exception, which is nice. But if you get a FERPTA distribution from a REIT, whether it's liquidating or whether it's a regular capital gain dividend that is FERPTA-tainted, there is a branch tax for a foreign government because it's treated like a corporation under 892A3, and also for any other entity that's a foreign corporation, or it may be a business entity, a foreign business entity, that's checked the box to be taxed as a corporation. And if you're not treaty protected, you know, Singapore, any Middle Eastern country, if you're not treaty protected, you have no option, really, except to pay 54.5% on a REIT capital gain dividend that's FERPTA-tainted, unless you can somehow shoehorn yourself into the branch termination exception, which is very problematic. You won't plan into doing that. I mean, that may be a last-ditch effort, but it's not easy to branch terminate when you get a FERPTA dividend. I've heard tax lawyers argue that it should not be subject to the branch tax, but to me, there's an example in the branch tax regs that's pretty much squarely on point, and the legislative history in several bills makes it clear that Congress thinks they're subject to the branch tax. So keep that in mind when doing any structuring with REITs. Tax haven companies, not unusual to find individual investors who want to come through Cayman, as an example, to avoid U.S. estate tax, the death tax. They've got a foreign blocker interposed, and then invest either, you know, in U.S. real estate directly or in a REIT. Might be a private REIT. The second they get a FERPTA capital gain distribution that goes up to that Cayman company, no treaty, branch tax, very, very bad outcome. Now, you will find it occasionally. I'm aware, for example, in the last couple years, ran into a Greek company that had a ton of U.S. real estate. It was not a qualified resident of Greece, or so we understood. And they were paying 54.5% every year and had been for years. And they were looking to sell the stock of the Greek company to us. Now, I will tell you, that's not fun to be offered that little package. And again, good luck trying to figure out how to make your client happy buying into that structure. But that's what they wanted to sell. I think we can go to 892.
Yeah,
okay.
92. Yep.
Patrick Fenn is going to talk about this. I'm not going to spend too much time other than to go through a few things. Again, foreign governments and their controlled entities can avoid tax on ordinary dividends, including ordinary dividends paid by REITs, non-FERPTA dividends. But you can't have actual control of the payor company or effective practical control. Effective practical control is an ugly, ugly concept. There's an example in the reg that is so grossly overbroad in the 892 regs about what might be effective practical control. They mention it, you know, being a substantial creditor and controlling a source of an important supply for the company might give you effective practical control. So they specify in the regs that ownership of 50% or more of vote or value is actual control. So the ability to deadlock the company is, quote, control. Counterintuitive, but that's what the regs and the statute tell you. If that's control, effective practical control, something less, then the question becomes, what kind of approval rights can you give a foreign sovereign, blocking or consent rights without causing the sovereign to creep into effective practical control. And in my experience, sovereigns want all the rights they can get. Okay? They don't care about effective practical control as long as a tax lawyer is not telling them that you lose. They want every right they can get. And people's sensitivities to this issue and how far they'll let them go varies, in my experience, depending on who's advising them, what they're accustomed to doing. I've seen them go for approval of annual business plan and budgets, for example, which I view as sort of a fundamental operational control issue, but you will certainly, I have seen it. Query what happens if you get three sovereigns together and they agree that all major decisions require all three of them to approve. I've seen it argued that that's not effective practical control, and yet each one can deadlock. And you wonder, why is that so different from the 50-50 deadlock case, which is control as defined? Better, in my view, if two sovereigns out of the three can vote and cut the other one out. Then I don't think any one of them has control by themselves, effectively or not. Fund sponsors are not, you know, they can't just stand on the sidelines on this issue because they're the withholding agent. If they get a W-8 EXP from the sovereign that says I'm 892 eligible, they know what the deal is. They know what the approval rights are. They've got to be reasonably comfortable as a withholding agent, you know or have reason to know that you're not qualified. You have all the facts. So you're going to be a party to those discussions, but probably, you know, much less. You're going to let them carry the mail. It's their substantive issue, but you are a withholding agent. The proposed 892 regs issued last year would confirm that, and I guess I should back up, you can't have commercial income in your controlled entity from any source, any place worldwide, or you blow the 892 status for that entity. People have wondered if FERP to capital gain distributions, while concededly taxable as a substantive matter, do they constitute commercial income? The proposed regs say no. That's a position I think many of us had been advising our clients was reasonable and ought to be the right answer. The proposed regs finally confirm that. Last point under 892 is we've been talking about the domestically controlled REIT exception and any foreign investor being able to sell domestically controlled REIT shares free of FERPTA tax, even though it's a U.S. REIT. Under 892, you can do something in addition. You can sell a minority interest. Remember, you can't have effective practical control. But if it's a minority interest in a foreign-controlled REIT, the regs expressly override FERPTA in that context. No FERPTA tax. 892 trumps. The theory is that's a security gain, and we're not going to tax it. And that can be very useful in structuring some of the sovereign transactions. Foreign U.S. RIPIC problem. This is a trap, and I will mention it, and see if I could summarize it this way. If your controlled entity of the sovereign is classified as a foreign U.S. real property holding company, applying the identical U.S. RIPIC principles that we all kind of familiar with for U.S. codes, if that controlled entity, that foreign controlled entity itself would qualify as a U.S. RIPIC, but albeit a foreign one, it becomes a commercial entity and it can't claim 892. If you own an interest, if you're a controlled entity of a foreign sovereign and own a minority interest in a foreign-controlled REIT, foreign-controlled REIT shares a FERPTA interest. You've now got a FERPTA interest in the numerator and nothing in the denominator except the FERPTA interest. You've got a U.S. RIPIC, a foreign U.S. RIPIC, you lost 892. This is a trap provision of the worst sort. I was hoping the proposed regs would yank it. It absolutely makes no sense in this context for a number of reasons. But you've got to be aware of it. There are things you can do to try to structure around it, but none of them are pleasant. And Ameek, you want to go to external?
Sure. So we have a few slides around this, but I think it's most useful to focus on the picture. This is a very common structure using a REIT in terms of doing a cross-border deal. You've got domestic institutions or individuals. Again, they tend to like REIT structures because you get 1099s as opposed to K-1s from various states. It's a structural UBIT blocker. So your domestic investors, their sort of structural interests are aligned with the foreigners. We've put a sovereign wealth fund up there, but this could be non-resident individuals, corporations, pension trusts, et cetera. You've typically got a fund, an LP It can be an LLC, obviously. LPs are a little easier in terms of 894C type considerations and treaty benefits. And that's the level. The promoter might have a carry at that level. Management fees maybe at the REIT level, but the carry at the fund level. And then you can have one or more subsidiary REITs. Now, this, as we said, this is a very common structure, normal real estate operating income. Rent minus any interest expense and dividends is paid out as dividends up to at the fund level. And at the fund level, there'll be the normal 1441 et sec withholding, often reduced by treaty. To the domestic investors, they get a K-1 with a nice simple REIT dividend on it. The plan in this structure is that the fund will exit at the end of the life of the fund by selling shares. And again, as we talked about, it'll be possible to give the buyer a basis step up, even though the foreigners have not paid tax on the gain on the sale of shares. You can give the buyer a basis step up. You can, in most instances, get them comfortable that the target operated as a REIT when it was supposed to operate as a REIT. In the old days, we used to tell people, if you go into this structure, expect pushback and haircuts from buyers. You're seeing less pushback and less haircuts from buyers. And then the difficulty with this structure is there's no structural shield. If any of these REITs actually sell assets, there's a property condemnation by a municipality, they've got somebody made an offer you can't refuse. A sale of assets at the REIT level will trigger the 897 H1 problem, which will tear up from the REIT to the fund onto the SWF and the other non-resident investors who'll have to pay tax.
And remember, it's not just paying. It also is a tax filing obligation.
Yes,
and there are sovereigns out there, because of their structure or peculiar business considerations they may have, it is an anathema to them to be filing a U.S. return. There's nothing right. being hidden, but for whatever reason, it gets more complicated if they start to have filers, okay? And the second you have a dollar of FERPTA gain, the amount may be insignificant.
Right.
But if it flows out from selling one small asset at a gain, and you have no choice but to designate it as a capital gain and pay it out,
So the question is, how much of that can you negotiate up front that this will never happen and that there will only be a sale of shares on exit? And increasingly, you're seeing people make stronger and stronger commitments to the foreigners. A quick word, there is this thought, again, we covered it a little earlier in the slides, that can you bootstrap domestically controlled status of a subsidiary REIT through the parent REIT, and then it sort of reinforces favorable tax statuses at either level. This is one of those things we think is too good to be true and therefore probably isn't.
So now to switch to sort of an internal domestically controlled REIT, internal in the sense of many sovereigns, particularly since 2007 when everything went to hell in a handcart, have wanted to control their own destiny more than ever, and which has put more pressure on 892 with consent rights, approval rights. I mean, they really don't want to be hostage to anybody else's desires. And so the thought is, well, if we can't have it all, what about going with a middle position where we set up our own domestically controlled REIT, forming our own U.S. corporation that we own 100% of, the foreign government does, but that will in turn acquire 51% of a REIT that will then acquire the real estate in question. The other 49% of the REIT is owned directly by the sovereign. And the thought is that we use the C corporation, which is the actual owner of the REIT shares and ought to be viewed as the owner for the DC REIT exception. It's a domestic person, even though ultimately owned by a non-US investor. That ought to work. And then what you're conceding to the government is that the US co is going to pay tax when the REIT pays dividends or when the REIT liquidates, sells its property. But if you can do a share sale, while US co is going to be a taxpayer on 51%, that's acknowledged, and state tax too, potentially. The 49, the idea is to get avoid FERPTA tax on the 49%. Boost your overall yield with half a loaf instead of the full loaf, but you control your own destiny. Now, one problem is dividends paid by US co in this structure can be problematic in terms of the withholding rate. Why? Because 892 won't apply because you've got effective practical control of the U.S. company. You own 100% of it. So you're conceding 892, knocking it out of the picture for dividends going outbound. And then treaty protection may be problematic. A lot of treaties have a pension article, like Article 35 of the Dutch Treaty, Article 21 of the Canadian Treaty. That's all great, but if you receive dividends from a related person, you don't get the benefit of that treaty, of that exemption. And so dividends outbound from USCO are a problem, and the idea is hopefully you don't pay many dividends. Maybe you lever USCO up and you're paying most of its income out as interest, which is exempt. So you got to deal with that side of it if you're going to go internal.
Let's move in the interest of time to the leverage structure at the very end. There's another intermediate structure in here if there's going to be asset sales at the REIT level, and this blocks the sovereign wealth fund from tax filing obligations.
This would be slide 239.
Yeah. But this is a tried and true structure. So suppose you don't have sovereign wealth funds, so all the Section 892 planning is gone. Suppose you've got a kind of deal where REITs don't make sense. It's either you've got a family and they're the investors, so you'd violate the closely held requirement for a REIT, or you're doing dealer property kind of development and sell. So those kinds of things you can't use a REIT for. And so then you're back to sort of, you know, 10, 15 years ago and a common structure like this, which basically uses a C-corp as a blocker to take care of the filing. You've got a debt co that funds, and the availability of the portfolio interest exemption by having voting and non-voting stock, voting in the hands of the promoter, and non-voting stock in the hands of the investor. Pete, do you have any additional comments on this?
Well, I guess a couple thoughts. You know, why do we have debt co and equity co side by side? The answer there is, and there are really not enough facts in the chart here to let you know why, but you're trying to avoid the earnings stripping limitations. If your ownership up above in the investor base is sufficiently diverse that you meet the 1563 controlled group test, or avoid being a 1563 controlled group, then interest paid to debt co is not paid to a related person within the meaning of 163J, which means that even if your debt to equity ratio exceeds 1.5 to 1 in US co, you don't have to worry about the 50% of adjusted cash flow limitation kicking in on you, because debt co is not related in the 163J sense. For that to happen, the investors have to be the right mix and sufficiently diverse. For example, you couldn't have an investor who is a corporation owning more than 50% of both companies. Now you got a 1563 control group. They're all related under 163J. Same thing if you had five individuals, five or fewer, owning more than 50% of both companies. Problem. So you need sufficient diversity. If you couldn't get there, you didn't have it, then you'd combine equity co and debt co in this structure. Yep. You could combine them. And they would hold both the debt and the non-voting equity. But the key for the portfolio interest exemption is the voting stock's got to be parked with somebody else, and it's got to be real. They've got to control the vote. There can't be any proxies to, you know, you can't have arrangements designed to ensure they're going to vote this way or that at the direction of the non-voting stockholder.
And they have to have skin in the game.
That's a big question mark. But if they don't have it, they don't have it. And then the question is, how much equity do you need to have in the voting stock block? There's going to be a lot of pressure to skinny that down, because nobody really particularly wants the voting equity to be represent a large chunk of the equity, just as a business matter. And yet it needs to be something significant. Are we out of time?
Yeah, I think we are. Very good, folks. Thank you.
Yep, 505. Thank you.
Peter, thank you. That was excellent. That was really great. Thank you very much. Yeah, we're good. Thank you so much.
Excellent.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for coming up. Thank you. That was great.
Excellent
presentation.
Oh, well, thank you.
You guys
much.
Did a great job.
Sorry for running a little late.
No, that's great. You guys did a great banner job.
Okay. Our final session this afternoon is going to be focused on the U.S. taxation of foreign governments and sovereign wealth funds, which are a very significant source of investment capital in the United States. Patrick Fenn, a well-recognized expert on this topic, is going to be leading this final discussion. Patrick is a tax partner with Akin, Gump, Strauss, Hauer, and Feld, where he co-heads the firm's tax practice in New York. Patrick's practice focuses on various aspects of tax planning, including cross-border M&A and tax planning for private equity funds, hedge funds, and sovereign wealth funds. Patrick.
This is a clicker. All right, it's 5 o'clock. It's time for 892. Well, I don't have 239 slides. And a lot of my thunder might have been stolen by Peter in the last round. But I'm here to talk to you about how foreign governments are taxed in the United States, how foreign governments and their controlled entities are taxed with respect to their investments in the United States. As a starting point, I think it's better to think of the tax treatment of foreign governments in the same way that you think about and it's been talked about today as the tax treatment of a foreign corporation. Under the Treasury regulations, a foreign government is treated as a foreign corporation and is generally subject to the rules applicable to any other foreign corporation that makes investments in the U.S. I think if you think of it that way, after we go through Section 892 and the special tax regime that's applicable to foreign governments, I think you'll see that 892 is a fairly limited benefit to a foreign government. It's not to say that in those cases where it applies that it's not quite valuable, but after we talk about these rules and narrow it down to what it actually applies to, I think you might wonder what all the fuss is about. Some of the fuss has to do with the significant increase in investment in the United States by foreign governments, either through special purpose entities that have come to be known as sovereign wealth funds or sovereign development funds, or through controlled entities that are special purpose entities set up to make investments not only in the United States but also worldwide. Those investments cut across, you might be surprised, cut across a spectrum of industries, not just passive investments that you might think about when you think about investments in the United States by foreign governments, but to very strategic businesses cutting across entertainment, finance, real estate, of course, as Peter has pointed out, and also technology, all sorts of investments. And the focus of my talk is not so much on general portfolio activity, buying U.S. treasuries, but it's on the types of investments that foreign governments make in these private types of investments that are privately negotiated transactions that are the heart of the benefit of the exemption for the foreign government. So it's also worth pointing out that the history of the foreign government exemption regime under Section 92 parallels the development of the sovereign immunity exemption in the United States since 1917. That sovereign immunity exemption was the basis for the development of the commercial activities test, which we're going to talk about, which really is at the heart of some of the most complicated aspects of Section 892. And that is that sovereign immunity to a foreign government in general was thought not to exist when the foreign government was engaged in a commercial activity in the United States. And I'm talking not about tax now, I'm talking about general liability, the right of a third party to sue a foreign sovereign. So some of the concepts that you see in Section 892 may appear very strange. In fact, they are. In fact, they don't work very well, and it's a big mess, largely because it's grown out of a series of changes to the tax law, changes to the regulations, and you'll see that because it doesn't have a consistent thread, and some of the rules, as Peter has already pointed out, really don't make a lot of sense. It can be counterintuitive and difficult to understand. Okay, let's get on with Section 892 and its workings. So the code does not define what a foreign government is. The Treasury regulations define it by reference to two things. One, what's called an integral part of a foreign government, and the other is referred to as controlled entities of a foreign government. The first category you can see on the slide, the integral part of a foreign government, is a concept that it's any person that constitutes the government authority of a foreign country, that its earnings, its net earnings, are credited to its own account or any other sovereign account, and no portion of the earnings inure to the benefit of a private person. It also encompasses pension funds, which are not set up as pension trusts, and we'll talk about that in a minute. The concept is that the foreign government is a kind of amorphous body, and any one of its instrumentalities qualifies as an integral part of a foreign government, as long as it constitutes a governing authority of a foreign country. Some of the hardest stuff about 892 is these kind of definitional terms, which you kind of scratch your head over when you get down to trying to understand, is an entity an integral part, or is it part of a second category of foreign government, which is called the controlled entity of a foreign government. Now, the controlled entity of a foreign government, again defined by regulations to be an entity that is separate in form from the foreign government or otherwise constitutes a separate juridical entity. Now think of that as a legal entity. I mean, the best way to think about the difference between an integral part and a controlled entity is probably the obvious one, and that is that the controlled entity is a separate legal entity formed by the government. And you'll see that one of the requirements is to be a controlled entity is that it has to be organized under the laws of the foreign government by which it is owned. It also has to be wholly owned by the foreign government, directly or indirectly through one or more other controlled entities. And again, like the integral part, no portion of the earnings can inure to a private person. And maybe most importantly, although it doesn't mean it's not a controlled entity, it changes the tax treatment that it doesn't engage in a commercial activity. So again, the distinction that we're going to see throughout this discussion is that of an integral part versus that of a controlled entity. And if you picture it, and I've got some pictures later, and if I jump to them, I probably won't be able to get back. Think about, for the most part, you have either the foreign government investing directly in a U.S. corporation or in a U.S. partnership, and that has that has tax consequences, and you apply 892 to the integral part. The interesting thing about integral parts is that even if they do earn commercial activity income, which we'll talk about, which is generally income that is not exempt under Section 892, if the integral part earns that type of income, it pays tax on it, but it doesn't prevent the foreign government or any other integral part of a foreign government from continuing to claim Section 892 benefits with respect to its other U.S. source income. So keep in mind that when you think of that, when we think about that and we talk about this, it's as though the foreign government were acting directly. When a foreign government acts through a controlled entity, it would set up a legal entity, it'll own 100% of it, it'll be organized under the laws of the jurisdiction of the sovereign, and that entity then will make the investment in the United States, either again in a U.S. corporation or in a U.S. partnership or in some other form of investment structure in the United States. Now, we'll talk about controlled entities more. It's hard to give this talk without mixing up, trying to get everything out at one time, but the difference, keep in mind, of a controlled entity is if it earns a dollar of commercial activity income. And again, I know we haven't talked about commercial activity income, but just to juxtapose these two concepts because the Congress felt the need to distinguish between them for some reason. If a controlled entity of the foreign sovereign earns a dollar of commercial activity income, it loses its exemption with respect to any other U.S. source income that it has. And that commercial activity income can be from anywhere in the world. So part of the exercise in advising foreign sovereigns with respect to their controlled entities is to make sure that the controlled entity never earns a dollar of commercial activity income. There's a third category that I have in the slide that really is a subcategory, pension plans that are formed as pension trusts. you can see the requirements for that, but these are really treated otherwise as controlled entities of foreign governments, where again, pension funds that benefit employees of the foreign government and not employees of the controlled entity are treated as integral parts. So let's talk about the scope of the exemption and what types of income qualify for the 892 exemption and what types of income do not qualify. And this would be true even if the foreign government, this distinction between what is exempt and what is not exempt would be true even if the foreign government or its controlled entity were not engaged in any commercial activity. That is, there are just certain types of income that are exempt and there are certain types of income that are not exempt, no matter whether you're carrying on a commercial activity. So what does qualify is income received by a foreign government. Let me see if I can, income received by the foreign government from investments in stocks, bonds, and other securities. So that's pretty simple. That generally means dividends, interest, and capital gains. Now, we're going to talk later, shortly, about how this category of income is impacted by the concept of a controlled commercial entity and by, again, the concept of commercial activity. So the second category of income is income from investments in financial instruments, including forward, futures, options contracts, swaps, or investments in precious metals. Now, it used to be, before the 2011 proposed regulations, that this second category of income was limited, that is, it was exempt only if it was pursuant to or to, implementation or to effectuate government financial or monetary policy. That is, it was a very narrow category. The second category of income was exempt. The 2011 proposed regulations removed that limitation so that now, even if the sovereign wealth fund, or the foreign government or its controlled entity is not implementing a monetary policy, investments in these types of assets are potentially qualify for the 892 exemption. And the last category is deposit interest. Let me say at this point that while we're talking about what qualifies for the exemption, it's interesting to note how this type of income would be taxed if it weren't for Section 892. And a lot of that you've already heard. So if you take, for instance, dividends, if a foreign corporation receives a dividend from a U.S. corporation, in the absence of an income tax treaty, it's going to be subject to withholding at 30%. Under the 892 regime, that withholding tax would not occur if the income is from a U.S. corporation that's not controlled by the foreign sovereign or the controlled entity. Interest, as Peter was talking about the portfolio interest exemption, ordinarily, even in the absence of 892, that interest may not be subject to U.S. tax, to U.S. withholding tax, if it qualifies as portfolio interest, even if there isn't a treaty. So in general, we'll see that the benefit of having an interest exemption under 892 is not with respect to just straight interest. It would be for any interest category that otherwise didn't qualify for the portfolio interest exemption, which would include, for instance, interest that is contingent on gross receipts or profits of the paying entity, or even if you owned more than even if the foreign sovereign owned more than 10% of the U.S. payor. So there's still benefit, even though there's a general interest exemption applicable to foreign persons. There's a general benefit to an 892 sovereign that would otherwise is in making an investment or even structuring an investment to take advantage of the interest exemption under Section 892. And capital gains of a foreign person from the disposition of stocks and securities, either held in investments or from trading in stocks and securities for its own account, are subject to an exemption. So this capital gains exemption, as we'll see, is largely, and as Peter has already talked about, and again, talked about most of the stuff that's exciting about 892, is this capital gains exemption really is important when a foreign sovereign is investing in U.S. real estate, and that investment can be structured through a corporate entity or other entity that permits the foreign sovereign to benefit from the 892 exemption. Peter talked about REITs. Those are primary vehicles for sovereigns to invest in the United States in real estate, and as Peter pointed out, can be structured to be very advantageous beyond the normal limitations that would apply to a foreign person investing in U.S. real estate that's not a sovereign. Let's see. So then what types of income are not exempt? So again, this type of income, even if you're not engaged in a commercial activity, is just not subject to any exemption under 892, specifically excluded. So that includes gains on the disposition of partnership interests or trust interests, other than dispositions of publicly traded partnerships. The second exception to the exemption is gain on commodity forward or futures contracts or options that are not securities under Section 864B. Third is gain on the disposition of a U.S. real property interest, and that means dirt. There's a distinction in this respect between an investment in U.S. real estate that is a hard asset and investment in a U.S. RPI that is the stock of a U.S. corporation that qualifies as a U.S. real property holding corporation. In that case, we'll talk about the ability of the sovereign to sell the stock of a U.S. real property holding corporation as long as the U.S. corporation is not a controlled commercial entity. Again, a significant benefit in structuring U.S. real estate investments. So we've seen already, as I've been talking, that the concept of a commercial activity is critical to understanding the limits of the scope of Section 892. That is, commercial activity carried on by either the foreign sovereign with respect to the income derived from the United States or by its controlled commercial and by its controlled entity will deprive the sovereign of the benefits of Section 892. So the concept of commercial activity governs both what income is exempt and whether, in the case of a controlled entity, whether the entity benefits at all from Section 892 exemption. Again, the code doesn't define what constitutes a commercial activity. The Treasury regulations define it quite expansively, and that is to say that it is all activities, whether conducted within or outside of the United States, which are ordinarily conducted by the taxpayer or by other persons with a view toward the current or future production of income or gain. So obviously, it's a very broad definition, and it's somewhat hard to understand in and of itself. I mean, what activity would you be conducting that has an investment posture, of course, that wouldn't be towards a view to production of income or gain? And that's not, in and of itself, mean that because there are exceptions to the commercial activity, but when you get outside of these exceptions and you're trying to figure out if some activity constitutes a commercial activity, this type of definition can be of very little help. You know, for instance, what we have found in advising sovereigns is that a lot of the sovereigns were long established not really with a view towards qualifying for Section 892 because they probably weren't making investments in the United States years ago. So they didn't really organize themselves in a way that they kept track of what types of activities they carry on within either the sovereign itself or certainly within their controlled entities. So the first thing you try to do when you're representing a foreign sovereign is understand what types of activities they carry on anywhere in the world, because again, a commercial activity is not just limited to what you're doing in the U.S. When you're talking about a controlled entity of the foreign sovereign, again, you have to be careful to understand whether that entity is carrying on any activities anywhere in the world that would be considered commercial activities. So there are these categories of exceptions from commercial activities, that is, activities that you can carry on even though they are for profit, and they won't be considered to be commercial activities. It doesn't mean that the income that you derive from that activity is exempt. It just means that you won't be engaged in a commercial activity, so that if you are deriving income from other U.S. from a U.S. source, that income can still qualify for Section 892. So, of course, a lot of the exemption categories kind of flow with the types of income you can earn that are exempt, but there are categories that are not exempt activities, not commercial activities, but don't generate exempt income. So the categories are of the types of commercial activities that are not, or sorry, types of investment activities that are not commercial are just normal investment activities in stocks, bonds, other securities, loans, interestingly, holding net leases on real estate, or land, which is not income producing, other than the fact you might sell it, or that you net lease the real estate. So net leasing of real estate is not a commercial activity for a foreign sovereign or for a commercial entity, a controlled entity of the foreign sovereign, but that income is taxable. So again, the point is that you're trying to make sure a controlled entity, which is almost always the focus, we rarely see integral parts, by the way. Most of the foreign sovereigns don't want the government dealing directly on a commercial basis. And so it's very rare that when you're investing in the United States in a joint venture, buying a strategic investment, or buying real estate, that you're gonna do that directly through an integral part. This is not done. It's unfortunate because it would be easier for the tax lawyer if the integral part undertook the investment in the U.S. because it can never taint any other U.S. source income that the sovereign may have. But when you do that through a controlled entity, you have to be very, as I say, you have to be careful that that activity doesn't give rise to commercial activity for the controlled entity. And these enumerate exceptions, which include some investments in the United States, means that the controlled entity still can qualify for 892, but it will pay tax on this type of income from real estate. And then any investments that are conducted through banking, finance, or similar business constitute a commercial activity, even if it's otherwise. So any qualifying income, that like interest on loans, other investment income that would otherwise be Section 892, if it's earned in a financial business of lending, it's going to be a commercial activity and taxable. Other exceptions affecting transactions in stocks and securities and commodities for the foreign government's own account. This is more like trading, active trading, like you would see hedge funds doing. So an investment by a controlled entity in a hedge fund or by a foreign sovereign in a hedge fund partnership that is trading in stocks and securities for the partnership's own account, that's not a commercial activity. And most of that income, again, to the extent it's exempt under 892, would be exempt. The third category are activities that are not customarily attributable to or carried on by private enterprise for profit. Again, a kind of a strange category. This can be helpful in certain cases. When we advise foreign sovereigns, what we have found is that they employ a lot of people. So you can have a sovereign wealth fund that's a controlled entity, that is a legal entity set up under the laws of the foreign jurisdiction, it employs a lot of people to carry out its investment activities. The controlled entity will make an investment in a U.S. corporation, and it will have its employees monitoring those investments, which probably isn't a commercial activity. But what if that employee provides technical support to the portfolio company? Is that a commercial activity? Even if the sovereign doesn't earn a profit from it, no payment. So and those types of issues are not answered by, and I think it's one of the, tried to get the this issue addressed by the proposed regulations. I think it's, as a practical matter, a considerable issue for a foreign sovereign that has hundreds or thousands of employees supporting its investment activities and its portfolio companies in the United States. Lastly, any activity performed in the execution of government function like cultural events or just purchasing goods for the sovereign or for the country is not commercial activity. Sorry, I can't do both. I don't know. I don't have that dexterity. So I'm sorry, I'm off my slides. Let's continue to talk about commercial activity. It's so much fun. Commercial activity can be attributed from another entity. You know, one entity's activities can be attributed to another, and therefore taint, if it's a controlled entity, taint that entity's ability to claim exemption under 892. A couple of rules laid out by the regulations. Apparent commercial activity is attributed to a subsidiary. So imagine a foreign sovereign establishing a controlled entity. That is, again, controlled entity is established under the laws of the jurisdiction of the foreign sovereign. It's 100% owned. And let's assume that entity sets up a subsidiary. All of them are investing in the U.S., the parent-controlled entity and the subsidiary-controlled entity. And the parent entity sells a hot dog in New Zealand. Now, that's a commercial activity for the parent, and it will taint the subsidiary-controlled entity. So if the subsidiary-controlled entity isn't itself conducting a commercial activity, it will lose its exemption with respect to any U.S. source income that it has that would otherwise qualify for 892. So the other rule is that it doesn't work the other way ordinarily. That is, there's no attribution from a subsidiary to a parent. So obviously the game is, if you're going to have a commercial activity, you try to isolate that in a subsidiary entity of the parent-controlled entity, or as a separate sister, brother-sister controlled entity of all your other controlled entities, so that there's no taint. There's no sideward or upward attribution of a commercial activity. There is attribution of commercial activities from partnerships to general partners and limited partners, unless the partnership is a PTP. Now, an exception to the limited partner attribution was part of the 2011 proposed regulations, and that says that commercial activities are not attributed to a limited partner if the limited partner does not participate in management or conduct the partnership's business. So the idea is that if you're a limited partner in a partnership and that partnership's conducting a commercial activity, since you're considered to be passive, if you're considered to be purely passive, you don't have a management role, that activity is no longer going to be attributed to the limited partner, controlled entity, or foreign sovereign. So in the controlled entity case, if you have a controlled entity that invests in a partnership in the U.S. and can be a limited partner, that is, have no role in management, while the income, again, might be subject to tax because the partnership itself may be conducting a trade or business that gives rise to taxable income, it won't be a commercial activity for the controlled entity, and it will be, that means that the controlled entity that otherwise has U.S. source income that is subject to exemption won't be tainted and can continue to claim that exemption. So lots of questions about what it means to participate in management and the partnership's business. The regulations say that consent rights to extraordinary events are not management rights, and that would be, for instance, change of the business of the partnership, change to the partnership agreement, things of that nature, change to the allocations or distributions of the partnership agreement. Those kinds of consent rights won't be considered to be participation in the management rights, but there's some concern that veto rights or membership on an advisory board of the partnership might be considered to be management. And not infrequently, sovereigns that invest in partnerships will be both a limited partner and they will own a piece of the general partner. So the question is, can you be a purely passive limited partner if in fact you own part of the general partner? All questions that have yet to be answered. So again, we're talking about when is a sovereign or its controlled entity engaged in a commercial activity. And we talked about what a commercial activity is, and we talked about exceptions to that, and then we're talking about attribution of commercial activity from one entity to another. And Peter already talked about the rule applicable to foreign U.S. RPHCs. That is the per se rule. So this rule says that a U.S. RPHC, a U.S. corporation that more than 50% of the assets of which are U.S. real estate, is engaged, is deemed to be engaged in a commercial activity, per se. And thus would be a controlled commercial entity with respect to the sovereign if the control test is met, and we'll talk about that in a minute. This rule that the U.S. RPHC is deemed to be a per se commercial activity applies to both domestic entities and to foreign entities. So Peter was talking earlier about this problem. This is what everyone calls the trap for the unwary, and it really is. What happens, foreign sovereign sets up a controlled entity. Again, that's a foreign entity set up under the laws of the jurisdiction of the foreign sovereign, wholly owned by the sovereign, and it acquires an interest in a U.S. RPHC, that is a U.S. corporation that owns predominantly real estate. And let's assume that the amount of the stock that the controlled entity owns is under 50%. So the U.S. RPHC is not a controlled commercial entity. The rule states that if you test the controlled entity, the foreign corporation, under the same test that applies to a domestic corporation to determine whether it's a U.S. RPHC, if the answer to that is yes, then that controlled entity is now what's called a controlled commercial entity, which we're going to talk about in a minute, and therefore it loses the exemption, any exemption it has with respect to its investment in the U.S. RPHC. That is, dividends that come up from the U.S. RPHC or gains from the disposition of the shares of the U.S. RPHC are taxable. So this rule is known as a trap for the unwary, because you wouldn't think that that could possibly be the outcome, and you scratch your head and ask, well, why is this a rule? And no, I can't find one, Peter. No one can explain it.
I wonder why they didn't try to fix it.
It's a good question, and they keep, you know, everyone's brought it up again with them, and they haven't said anything about fixing it or not fixing it. It's unlikely to be fixed. Now, you can, as Peter said, there are ways to deal with this problem. They're not easy. If you put more assets into it that are non-U.S. real estate or other trade or business assets that are not U.S. real estate, so that the balance of the asset values, the U.S. real estate component of the controlled entity's assets is less than 50%, you're good. You've gotten out of the trap. But foreign sovereigns don't generally like to put, there are other implications to putting your non-U.S. real estate into the type of entity that is going to own your U.S. real estate. Secondly, there's an exception for an investment company. You can put investment assets into the controlled entity as long as those assets equate to more than 90% of the asset value of the controlled entity, even though it owns the U.S. real estate, which would only by definition be 10% or less, then you're out of the trap as well. So that might be an easier fix, because generally foreign sovereigns have a lot of these types of investment assets. I should say too that this rule that Peter and I are commiserating about is inconsistent with both the rule that stock is an investment in stock is not a commercial activity, as well as the principle that commercial activity is not attributed upstream from a subsidiary. So again, it's sort of, why is this rule there? Nobody can explain it, and why hasn't it gone away? All right, so we know that income derived from a commercial activity is not exempt, and I've already told you that that's important for the sovereign itself, or an integral part, because that means the income would be taxed. But I've also said, and I'd like to remind you, that that doesn't taint any other income earned by the foreign sovereign. But in addition to income derived from a commercial activity, income derived by or from a controlled commercial entity, I'm catching up to my slides. Income derived by or from a controlled commercial entity is not exempt from taxation under Section 892. A controlled commercial entity shouldn't really be confused with a controlled entity. I know this is where it gets a little bit confusing. A controlled commercial entity does not need to be formed under the laws of the jurisdiction of the sovereign, and it doesn't need to be wholly owned by the sovereign in order to be considered to be a controlled commercial entity. What it is an entity that meets two tests. There's an activities test and there's an ownership test. And the activities test is that the entity is engaged in a commercial activity anywhere in the world. Now, you knew the answer to that, right? Because all we've been focused on is commercial activity. Commercial activity is the bane of the existence of sovereigns. So an entity that is engaged in a commercial activity, that's the first test. So we're looking at an entity and we're trying to determine whether it's a controlled commercial entity, because income derived by a controlled commercial entity from the United States is not exempt. An income that it pays up to a sovereign is not going to qualify for the 892 exemption. And a disposition of the shares of a controlled commercial entity by the sovereign is also not going to be exempt. Other than under the normal rules, again, remember there's this overlay. The 892 is an overlay on the general tax regime applicable to foreign persons. So I don't want to give you the impression that if you don't qualify for 892 that you're always going to be subject to U.S. tax. You're not. You're not. It's going to be very limited categories, again, that don't qualify for 892 and that are subject to U.S. tax. And they normally are dividends and disposition gains from U.S. real property interests. Now, the second test, there are two tests, as I said, for a controlled commercial entity, and the other test is an ownership test. The foreign government has to directly or indirectly hold 50% or more of the interest of the entity by vote or value, or it holds sufficient interest in the entity so that the government has effective practical control over the entity. This is something that Peter raised earlier. There's no definitive guidance on what effective practical control is. The regulations say that it includes a significant minority interest that's significant enough to actually have control, give the sovereign control. And it can be other things like being a creditor and also being a shareholder, or having other contractual or regulatory relationships between the sovereign or the controlled entity and the entity that we're testing to see whether it's a commercial controlled entity. All right, those are a lot of rules, and I'm sorry to put you through that at 540 or whatever it is, but that's section 892. But so where does that leave us? I mean, where does that, after all is said and done, what's the incremental benefit to a sovereign for qualifying for 892? Well, I think it boils down to really three significant benefits. One is an exemption of dividends from non-controlled U.S. corporations. So a sovereign or a controlled entity that owns less than 50% of a U.S. corporation and receives a dividend doesn't pay tax on the dividend. It also extends to an exemption on interest from non-controlled U.S. borrowers. That is again significant where the interest otherwise wouldn't qualify for the portfolio exemption. Again, contingent interest or interest that would be paid from an entity that is more than 10% owned by the foreign sovereign. And then exemption on gains from the disposition of an interest in a non-controlled U.S. RPHC. So again, the focus is on control. With respect to income received by or from a controlled commercial entity, which is really where the sticking point is for a foreign sovereign, the emphasis is on determining whether that entity carries on a commercial activity and determining whether or not the sovereign meets the ownership test, either through stock ownership or interest ownership or through effective practical control. In 2011, the government issued proposed regulations which were welcomed by the tax bar, although they didn't go as far as some of us wanted them to in terms of either extending the scope of 892 or defining the scope of 892 more definitively. But one thing it did that's, I think, going to be a one-eyed man with a limp kind of exception is this so-called inadvertent activity exception to commercial activity. So assume that you are investing in your controlled entity is either a partner in a partnership and it doesn't meet the limited partner definition, or it's investing in another activity in the United States that you think is not a commercial activity but it turns out to be a commercial activity. There is an exception now in the regulations that gives the foreign sovereign or its controlled entity the ability to ignore that effectively if it meets certain requirements. yeah, here we go. So these requirements are rather lengthy. I think the important highlights of them are that the failure has to be reasonable and it's a facts and circumstances test. There is a safe harbor. If the assets that are considered to be the commercial activity or the income from the commercial activity is less than 5% of the assets or the gross income of the entity. There's also requirements to continue to do due diligence as to whether or not the entity is engaged in a commercial activity. There are certain record keeping rules. And there is a requirement of curing, which is a very strange requirement when you think about you have to either somehow you have to within 120 days solve your problem. That is, you have to dispose of the commercial activity within 120 days or move it to an entity that will cut off the commercial activity from flowing up to the controlled entity or the sovereign. We've seen, and I do a lot of work with private equity funds, and the private equity funds have a lot of investors that are 892 investors, and this has become an ask. That is, everybody wants to see, every 892 investor wants to, in a private equity fund, wants to see this exception spelled out in the partnership agreement, and I refuse to do it because it seems to me to be impractical. Another benefit of the regulations, 2011 regulations, I've already been over. It's this exception for limited partners, anyone who can qualify for limited partner status. I think that is a significant benefit. I think it makes a lot of sense. It would be nice to have some guidance from the government on the issues that we've already discussed around what constitutes participation in management. Again, with respect to private equity funds in particular, the big investors, including a lot of the 892 investors, will ask for or will be offered seats on an advisory board of the general partner. It's not necessarily a decision-making body, but it does have some say over portfolio activity. And the big question, you know, one of the questions is that participating in management? I don't think so, but it would be nice to have some more guidance on that. There's also things like observer rights or consultation rights. The same issues arise. There are other aspects of the regulations that were also helpful. They're more technical, they're less practical, but they're helpful. Lastly, I don't know if you all have talked about FATCA today. I assume a little bit. Anyway, terrible regime. Anyway, the good news is that if you're a foreign sovereign and you're not engaged in a commercial activity, you can give a certificate that has the, 29 boxes on it, right? You check, I think it's box number 8 is for a foreign sovereign, and you can give that certificate to any FFI, a foreign financial institution that is interested in your status, and that's the end of it. You don't have to identify every single person in the population of the foreign government in order to satisfy the U.S. government that no U.S. person is hiding in the population. So anyway, that brings me really to the end. I did have some pictures. These really just summarize what I tried to do. I've got a minute or so left. What I tried to do was just break this down again to where how you would see this graphically, in terms of it being the benefits and of 892 and where 892 applies and where it doesn't. So the first slide shows the government investing directly in a U.S. corporation that's not a U.S. RPHC. And even though it's an operating company and carrying on a commercial activity, the government doesn't own more than 50%, so dividends and gains would be exempt under 892. In that context, though, the gains would be exempt without regard to 892. The second one shows the government owning less than 50% of a U.S. RPHC, and again, the disposition of shares and dividends would not be subject to U.S. tax, which is a big benefit. And then the other case, where it owns more than 50% of a U.S. RPHC, controlled commercial entity, and therefore no exemption under 892 for either dividends or capital gains. And then the last is the more than 50% of a U.S. RPHC, a non-U.S. RPHC, and the exemption does not apply. Same basic structure for controlled entities, although you'll see on the far right corner the problem with the per se rule, that in that case, you're right. That's the deemed USRPHC problem. That is, you have a controlled entity that is set up under the laws of the government jurisdiction. It owns nothing but a U.S. corporation that's a USRPHC, and it's deemed to be engaged in a commercial activity, and therefore gains and disposition income are not subject to the 892 exemption. All right, that's got to be enough, right?
Okay. Well, we've covered an awful lot of ground today. I thank you all exploring the various tax planning for U.S. inbound investment. Just as a reminder with respect to CPE and CLE, to claim your CLE, you need to fill out a green evaluation form and just drop it out as you leave and drop your NYU scannable card in the box designated for that. For CPE, for the CPAs, also the evaluation form and the yellow CPE form, and you can claim both if you wish, in which case, just need one evaluation form. So thank you very much for attending. Meeting adjourned.